The Times or subscribe for €5 a month at thetimes.ie/join.
Have a cracking Christmas with Centra. We have great offers, like Nestle After 8 carton 300 gram, half price at €3.25. And our cracking offers until Sunday, Club Orange 18-pack cans only €6, and selected 12-pack cans like Guinness and Heineken, any two for €20. Centra, live every day. Enjoy call sensibly.
World Day of Remembrance for Road Traffic Victims is this Sunday. So take a moment to remember the 24,389 people who've died on our roads since records began. Over 24,389 families, groups of friends, communities. Let's remember them to prevent further tragedy. Find a service near you at rsa.ie.
Your life doesn't just magically happen. You build it. Taking time and care to construct something that works for you. Gathering the things that make your life better. Full. Things that fit. Things you need. Things you love. Whatever car you choose needs to fit your life seamlessly. And however you choose to live, there's a 201 Mini made for you and your world. Explore the 201 range at mini.ie or your local retailer. Drive Mini, live major.
The wait is over. The shopping event of the year is here. Get Black Friday discounts today. Save €80 on the Bosch Series 4 heat pump dryer, now just €429. Or get the Tassimo Vivi coffee machine, now just €35, saving €84. And at Harvey Norman, we're matching all competitors' Black Friday prices, so why shop anywhere else? Don't wait until Black Friday. Now's the time to buy, in-store or online. Harvey Norman Black Friday sale.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
All right, you're very welcome along to the RDS. What a start it was to the day already. Ulster 17-16 winners against Bath at the Rec. Brilliant action there coming from England. John Cooney's late penalty, 9 minutes from full time, enough to get Ulster over the line and 4 points away from home in the opening day. A brilliant return, especially with Claremont visiting Belfast next week. A fantastic start for them. Bath, just like last season, beaten on the opening day at home. Last season it was Toulouse, this season it was Ulster. Time now to turn our attentions to Leinster against Benetton. Kickoff just over 10 minutes away. And beside me this afternoon, I have two former Leinster players, Liam Toland and Andy Dunn, alongside me. Afternoon, gents. You were watching the last few minutes of that Bath game. I think you missed the final points in the press room there, Liam. You were surprised when you came up and heard that they'd just taken the lead.
Yeah, I'm delighted because, like, from an Ulster point of view, we know how good they can be in Ravenhill, and we know how strong and how difficult it is to win up there. But for them to win on the road is hugely important, and in the manner that they did win it as well. The fact that they were behind a couple of times and they kept finding a way to win it, it's very, very, like, Cooney missed a penalty, didn't he? He missed a penalty goal in front of the post. So to cater for those challenges and still come out with a win is hugely satisfying for Ulster.
Andy, Leinster this afternoon, Benetton up against them. Benetton, a very good record at the RDS in recent years. A draw last year and the season before that, actually beating Leinster. But this is a different story entirely. This is Leinster with a lot of internationals in there in a big game and a Heineken Champions Cup game, that a game that they're not going to be affording to lose.
Well, I think the days of the Italian sides purely, you know, turning up and being the whipping boys, I think those days are changing, at least. They may not be fully over. I still anticipate Leinster to get a win. But even based on the tail end of last season, watching Benetton's performance against Munster, where probably one or two passes, you know, sticking away from getting a famous win, and it would obviously knock Munster out of the Pro 14. It would have sent shockwaves through, you know, domestic rugby had it happened. But they were so damn close that day. And I think when a team plays the way they play, it's about sustaining that or sticking with that idea that they can remain creative and get better at being creative, and will be a threat to Leinster today as a result of that. Kieran Crowley is another ex-All Black and New Zealand coach, so comes in again with very much with that type of play being encouraged throughout his group, and they've got better at that creative attacking rugby.
It's even what part of the pitch they're playing. Just going back in the game that Andy's referring to in Thomond Park, like, the table position doesn't indicate how brilliant they can play rugby at times. So for me, coming into this competition, is can they adapt that, Dunner? Can they recognise that trying to attack every time you're inside your own 22, sometimes against the side of the quality of the winners of that particular competition, like, it's one step forward, maybe four steps back. But, like, I was at that game, that Munster-Benetton game, and Munster became more and more narrow, more and more conservative, more and more negative in how they're playing the game. And Benetton, as the game went on, became more and more adventurous. Like their ability to target weak shoulders and shift their feet and put a doubt in the defender's mind was as good as any team in Europe or in our domestic competition last season. The problem they have is that doesn't always win you games.
Well, I think the one differentiating factor from that side last May and this side today is Ian Keatley, a guy obviously with huge experience of playing in Ireland, in the, you know, in the cold weather in November. You know, well able and very capable of managing a game. That kind of that vague notion we all talk about, course management in golf, pitch management here, he'll be very familiar with the RDS, he'll be very familiar with the Leinster side. And I think he's a guy who can put his foot on the ball for Benetton, can maybe put the brakes on that craziness that they lend themselves to on occasion. Yeah. The relentless deep attacking, and
it's not like, if you look at the Italian sides, it's not some madness. It is a definite sea change in how they play the game.
Yeah, thanks a million, guys. So we just time to take one more break before kickoff. Leinster just coming out onto the pitch, or back into the change rooms. They'll be out shortly. There was one change for Leinster from the side that was named yesterday. Joe Tamani is pulled up with a slight hamstring injury, so in his place comes Rory O'Loughlin into the team, and Robbie Henshaw, who missed last week's game against Connacht, he is onto the bench. Kickoff just over 5 minutes away here at the RDS. We'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Off the ball on News Talk. Screen Time with John Farty.
Hang on, it's too early for that. But I do have to tell you that this week on Screen Time, I talked to director Paul Feig about his new rom-com Last Christmas, set to the music of George Michael. He also tells me about making Bridesmaids and why he could never make Freaks and Geeks again. And staying with the seasons, meteorologist Evelyn Cusack chooses her favourite movie.
Screen Time with John Farty.
Brought to you by Stella Cinemas.
Download and subscribe to the podcast now, or tune in this evening at 6.
On News Talk.
Productive afternoons with Harvey Norman. Need more you time? Ask about our range of large capacity washing machines with quick wash functions in Harvey Norman today. Now, where's the remote?
Go, Harvey, go!
What would you expect from the new Volkswagen Passat? An elegant dynamic exterior and spacious interior? Advanced driver assistance systems for easier, safer driving? A plug-in hybrid option for a cleaner, greener drive? Expect all that and more, so you can be more and do more. The new Volkswagen Passat. What did you expect? Search Volkswagen Passat.
The Killers in Floating the Mirage Tour. Malahide Castle, June 16th, subject to license. Plus special guest, Sam Fender. Tickets from $69.90 on sale this Friday at 9 a.m. Additional charges may apply. The Killers live at Malahide Castle. Tickets on sale this Friday.
So you've got my watch, my hat,
no.
My coat, and my favourite rugby shirt.
No.
Let's call it even.
But sir, it's free.
What?
Your PRSI contribution entitles you to a free eye test at Specsavers and glasses from our €69 range.
I'd better put my clothes back on.
This week at Dunstores, save more on your Christmas shop with 20% off when you buy any 6 bottles of wine. Plus 3 for €5 on Cadbury, Nestle and Mars medium selection boxes. And with our 10 off 50 grocery voucher, save even more. Dunstores, always better value. See online for terms and conditions. Minimum spend required. Please drink responsibly.
This is the sound of a Volkswagen master technician servicing your Volkswagen using their expertise, specialist tools, and Volkswagen genuine parts. It all clicks perfectly together, making sure your Volkswagen stays a Volkswagen. Book a classic service from €169, including 1 year complimentary roadside assistance at volkswagenservice.ie, and make sure it stays a Volkswagen. Terms and conditions apply.
Play it, wear it, live it. Whatever you're looking to buy, why not Flexify it? Choose a payment plan that suits you from a wide range of retailers across Ireland. Buy now and pay later with Flexify.com. Terms and conditions apply. See Flexify.com.
I don't know. I'm not in that mindset.
I don't have time. Yeah.
It's just keep going. And maybe not thinking of those things, whether it's a mental block, I don't know. Yeah, it's probably something we do need to think about.
We've never discussed it.
Jane, it would be a huge relief to know that you're financially secure in some way. Yeah. It would be for the benefit of our kids if anything happens to either of us.
No one should spend time thinking about the worst things that can happen. That's why VHI has made setting up life insurance simple. Search VHI Life and get a quick quote or call us on 1890 44 44 44. VHI Healthcare DAC trading as VHI Healthcare is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland and is tied to Zurich Life Assurance PLC for VHI Life Term Insurance.
Do you have a TV licence? Inspectors are calling to unlicensed homes and businesses. If you don't, that can mean prosecution and a fine of up to €1,000. It's the law, so get yours at tvlicense.ie or at any post office. Brought to you by the Government of Ireland.
Why wait for Black Friday when our amazing Black Tag sale is now on at Currys PC World? Get your kitchen ready for Christmas with an LG American-style fridge freezer with water and ice dispenser from $999. Or pick up a DeLonghi bean-to-cup coffee machine with selected models better than half price from $399. Get our lowest ever price on the 32-inch smart JVC TV, now only $179. And we've got unbelievable offers across the store with laptops and tablets. Get in-store or online at currys.ie. T's and C's apply.
You can admire a new Mercedes-Benz from across a busy street, through the gate of someone else's driveway, or through your rearview mirror. But a new Mercedes-Benz can be even closer than you think. Introducing the 2020 range, including 8 brand new models at the Mercedes-Benz 2020 sales event from the 14th to the 16th of November nationwide. Mercedes-Benz. Better is closer than you think.
World Day of Remembrance for Road Traffic Victims is this Sunday, so take a moment to remember the 24,389 people who've died on our roads since records began. Over 24,389 families, groups of friends, communities. Let's remember them to prevent further tragedy. Find a service near you at rsa.ie.
Switch to Air Broadband this Christmas and get Amazon Prime Video on us for a whole year. Enjoy thousands of movies, TV series, Amazon Originals, and the Air Sport Pack on us. With unlimited broadband for just $49.99 a month for life. Call 1-800-500-300, go in store, or visit air.ie. Air, let's make possible. New customers only. 12-month contract. Subject to availability. Bundle activation fee may apply. For full details and terms, see air.ie/Prime Video.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
All right, you're very welcome back again to the RDS. The teams are both out on the pitch. Leinster against Benetton kicking off in just a matter of moments. Leinster playing down into the Anglesey Road end of the RDS here. Benetton kicking off. Ian Keatley holding the ball as Liam Toland and Andy Dunn are beside me and ready to go in this Pool 1 game in the Heineken Champions Cup. Our referee today of France, Pierre Brousset, is just chatting to Ian Keatley on the halfway line at the moment as Leinster set up and get ready to receive the ball. As I brought to you before kickoff as well, Joe Tamane out of the game means that Rory O'Loughlin is in and starts at first centre, while Robbie Henshaw, who missed last week's game against Connacht, comes in onto the bench and wears number 23. We are underway as the ball is kicked and Quaylen Doris collects it and is tackled just outside the 22 and is brought back in. Luke McGrath now with the ball outside and he sends it out, and Cian Healy with a strong carry gets over the 22 with a couple of metres, and it looks like Leinster are going to go back towards the right-hand side of the pitch as Josh van der Fleer in his trademark red scrum hat carries it up again. A few short carries for Leinster, not gaining too much ground early on as Luke McGrath looks to box kick now out of the 22 and he sends that one. It's going to drop just inside the 10-metre channel and it's taken excellently by Treviso, who keep the ball in play and they set up what looks like a maul here now, just 40 metres out from the Leinster goal on the far side of the pitch. Their scrum half, Dual Duvenage on now, and strong carry up the middle, which is tackled by a Leinster player 40 metres from goal. Duvenage now again gets the ball out, and that's another decent carry stopped. Cian Healy there. Ian Keatley now gets the ball outside, and on it now is Nacho Brex, but he knocks it on and Devon Toner bats it back, and eventually Leinster knock on as well, and we are called back for a scrum to Leinster 38 metres out from their own goal, on the left-hand side of the pitch.
It seems a while ago, but what a wonderful exit from Cian Healy, the loosehead prop for Leinster. It was the first time in a long time I've seen an Irish forward carrying and then changing the point of attack, making it very difficult for the fringe defenders. He got a nice bit of space. Ultimately, they went to the box kick, but it was lovely to see a player of his athleticism putting that such pressure on about two or three of the Benetton defenders.
Cian Healy there with a strong carry early on, and a big day as well for Ronan Kelleher alongside him in the scrum today. His European debut after a fantastic start to the season so far. 6 tries for him in just as many as 5 games. I think the record in the Pro 14 for a hooker is 8 tries across an entire season. That was Rob Herring and Sean Cronin in the last couple of years, but a brilliant start to him for Ronan Kelleher, younger brother to Cian Kelleher, who has just returned back to Leinster this season, not involved this afternoon, as the first attempt of a scrum just drops down and we're going to reset it. Luke McGrath getting ready to put the ball back in.
You just mentioned Kelleher there. Like, it's, I don't know, Dunner, like, the opportunity of a clean slate, one of the great obvious ones is hooker. Like, there must be about 6 or 7 hookers around Ireland who feel, now's my chance. If I can just catch the imagination, there's great opportunity for them.
But he's from a strategic point of view, I think he's playing the Bernard Jackman school of hookers. He's always the man holding the ball at the base of that maul to score. So 6 tries where he's flopped over the line, but it doesn't take away from his overall performance. He's been excellent.
It's James Lona who takes the ball from Luke McGrath at the back of the scrum. Not much movement in the scrum there. Luke McGrath now gets it out to Johnny Sexton, who goes outside, and it's taken up there. And some good yards made, I think, by Rory O'Loughlin early on. And the ball is played outside now, and it's a decent carry by Quaylan Doris, who's tackled. Leinster finally moving into the Benetton half, and they have a penalty advantage. And the arm is up from referee Pierre Brousset, and Leinster have the opening penalty of the game just inside the Benetton half. And it looks like Johnny Sexton, what is he looking to do? I think holding on is the call from Brousset, and Johnny Sexton is going to put this one into the corner. Sexton just inside the Benetton half is lining it up, and kicks it right down into the corner, and Leinster will have a line-out midway between the 22 and the Benetton goal line. A very good attacking platform, Andy.
Absolutely. It'll be interesting to see will Leinster look to take this down and maul, which they've done very, very successfully in recent Pro 14 games. As I mentioned, Kelleher at the back of those driving mauls, but the maul itself has looked really strong for Leinster today.
And it's Quaylan Doris who goes up at the front of the line-out and has taken on Leinster, looking to maul it now, but they aren't getting much movement early doors in this maul. It is starting to get some head of steam now as Luke McGrath takes it off the back and puts it outside, and Rory O'Loughlin takes it up, but he is stopped well by the Benetton defence as Leinster move to within about 10-12 metres from the Benetton line. Luke McGrath now outside, and it's another strong carry there, and it's a miss which Leinster player it was. Sexton tries to swing it out the back door, but it's defended very, very well by Benetton.
I'd argue that it's defended too well. They're well offside on 3 separate occasions, definitely.
And the Leinster do have a penalty advantage. That was spotted by today's referee as Sexton now gets it outside. Gary Ringrose for the line, and Gary Ringrose, it looks like he's over. And Leinster, 4.5 minutes on the clock here, have their opening try of the game, using the penalty advantage to good effect, bringing the ball out wide. Johnny Sexton finding Gary Ringrose, and he fends off a couple of Benetton tackles and gets over about 5 metres from the left-hand side touchline. It's going to be a difficult conversion, but Leinster up and running well here now. 5 minutes on the clock, and they lead by 5 points to nil.
I think the speed of ball was the reason they were able to get the score there. They recycled it in less than 2 seconds for 2 or 3 rucks in a row. There was no time for Luke McGrath to be ponderous at the base of the ruck. He just whipped it out 2-3 times in a row.
Andrew Porter at first receiver there, getting it out to Johnny Sexton outside him.
Yeah, it's great to see the young guns. You've the likes of Porter, you've Ronan Kelleher, you've Caelan Doris in the Leinster pack. It'll be great to see what kind of impact they can make as young guns in a European game.
A rare start as well for Andrew Porter this afternoon, with Tadhg Furlong out with a back niggle as well. It is incredible how rare he actually is playing in these big games from the start.
Yeah, and I think of all the positions in our sport, tight head is one you got to play, and you can do a lot of practice scrummaging and that sort of stuff, but you've got to be out on the pitch playing, and he gets his overall season contribution in terms of minutes is very low, which is hampering his overall evolution. Like, he's a freak of an athlete, mm-hmm. So he needs time to get better and better.
Johnny Sexton now just a yard or so inside from the left-hand touchline. Very difficult conversion, hoping to bring it in on the right foot as he stands over and the RDS falls silent. Sexton getting ready to kick over the conversion after Gary Ringrose's opening score. 6 minutes here on the clock, Leinster leading 5-0. This to make it 7. Sexton, it is a decent enough strike. It looks like it has just drifted to the left and wide. He tried to bring it back in, but that has gone left and wide of the post. Leinster leading 5-0. Gary Ringrose's try, his opening try of the season for Leinster in his opening appearance. He wasn't one of the internationals who returned for last week's Pro 14 win against Connacht. But a good start for Leinster. 6.5 minutes gone here and they lead Benetton by 5-0 as Ian Keatley gets us back underway. And just as last time, Quaylen Doris takes it and charges up outside the 22. And it's Nasai Manu, who the number 8, who tackles Quaylen Doris and stops him just outside the 22. But a penalty for Benetton, as Leinster penalised for not rolling away, I think it was.
Well, as Darris went in, he gained great ground, really, really great ground, and Keane Healy flew in behind him, great height, shoulder height, hip height, and did a good clear out. Then it just kind of fell into trench warfare, didn't it? And it gave a bad picture to the referee who selected a penalty, and a big call from Keatley.
Not going for the post. This penalty was just outside the 22 and pretty much straight in front of the sticks. It was a gimme 3 points for Ian Keatley. And Andy, you have a bit of a grimace on your face looking at that.
I just have a pet hate when a team takes the option to go for the corner from 20 metres away from the corner and then doesn't kick it into the corner. He's kicked it halfway.
Nine metres out.
He's got to nail that on the 5 metre line to give his team. It's not good enough as a 10. You've got to nail that kick.
And they take it up. They win the line out and set up them all. They're going for the line. And I think at the back with the ball in hand now is Hame Faiva, the Benetton hooker. But they're not moving whatsoever. Leinster holding them up well, as Faiva still has it, and he breaks now from the back. And in the end, it's actually a decent enough carry. He gets a yard or two over the gain line, and they're edging their way closer towards the line. 2 metres out, another pick and go, and a third. They're still working their way towards it.
They have a problem because they've no backs at all. They've committed entirely to that, so they've no other option but to keep ploughing around the fringes.
Just about three or four players outside between the touchline and the post, as out on the wing, Angelo Esposito stands all alone. Not a hope he's getting the ball unless there's a miraculous crossfield kick as they continue to plough on with these pick and goes. That's a very good stop from Josh van der Fleer, just knocking them back another yard or so as they edge their way closer. 5-6 phases on now from that line out. Looking to hit right back after Gary Ringrose's try on 5 minutes for Leinster. Has them 5-0 up. We've 8.5 minutes gone here as Benetton continue to pick and go and pick and go, but it stopped once again. And are they over the line? They are. The try is awarded, and it looks like their second row, Dean Budd, Italian international, has got over the line after a series of pick and goes. And Andy, in the end, they've been vindicated. It worked.
Yeah, absolutely. I wasn't questioning the decision. I was questioning the execution. But they might have got there a little easier had he kicked it close. But they were pretty relentless there. Showed a lot of muscle, showed a lot of discipline actually to hold on to the ball, and well taken finish.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you one thing, Dunner. Budd ran into Porter initially, like of all the players in world rugby, you don't want to run into, and he still had the upper body strength to just twirl around and get it down.
That's just the same line was coming in on him as well. It's an absolutely brilliant finish.
Like there was no pace at all in anything, did it? It was just sheer muscle v muscle.
Yeah, and the other thing is Dean Budd's height. He's lost, you know, he's losing the centre of gravity battle straight away there, but he's managed to use a little bit of footwork.
Ian Keatley now with the conversion midway between the posts and the touchline, and he sent it between the posts, and Benetton into the lead here. They lead by 7-5 after Dean Budd's try, his first try of the season. He only recently returned one game for the club this season, having been on international duty with Italy, one of a number of players in this squad who had been on World Cup duty.
I know it's less significant, but the opening game of the season was Benetton 27 to Leinster 32 in Italy. I can't imagine the score would be that much.
Yeah, and of course both players were without a huge number of players. Italy with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 of today's match day 23 were away on international duty. 9 of those with Italy, and the only other one was Nasai Manu of Tonga, who was playing. This is actually his first appearance for the club. This is his second appearance, I should say. He played last week. His first appearance for Benetton in over a year. He missed the entirety of last season. He was out getting treatment for testicular cancer and came back fantastically in time to play at the World Cup for Tonga, his adopted country, born in New Zealand. But it was one of the great stories of the World Cup to see him back and finally back with Benetton as well. As Leinster get the ball now and spill it, but it has gone back. They're 10 metres inside their own half as Luke McGrath tries to find his way and burrow the ball out. Johnny Sexton, they go blindside out to James Lowe, who has a tackler hanging off his ankles and is eventually brought to ground. Luke McGrath now recycling. He's got a pot of forwards. Devon Toner, the man to take it, who just pops it outside. And that's a really strong carry by Reese Ruddock to get them another extra, or James Ryan to get them another extra yard. Rory O'Loughlin now finds some space, and Josh van der Fleer, and that's out well to out to Dave Kearney. Leinster into the Benetton half and have the penalty advantage. Luke McGrath to Johnny Sexton, who goes back inside, and Leinster working their way down the pitch now. They're around 35 metres from goal, still penalty advantage as McGrath picks it up with another pot of forwards, but we are coming back from the penalty right on the 10 metre line, 10 metres inside the Benetton half. Benetton penalised for not rolling away.
I think it's notable to look at Leinster's handling there. We sometimes gloss over what appear to be basics, but we probably hadn't seen that in throughout the World Cup with the Irish side. Is simple, accurate passing while players are running straight. They're preserving space for their outside runners. And what happened was they managed to suck in Benetton purely through quality of passing. It looks easy. It's difficult to do in truth and execution. I think it's worth noting that the Leinster side seem to have just fallen straight into that pattern, which is a nice one.
Adding to that, the Leinster pack aren't dominating. It's pretty 50-50. So it is that quality of passing and accuracy that's giving them a foothold.
12 minutes gone here at the RDS. Benetton leading by 12 or by 7 points to 5. Dean Budd's try on 8 minutes, cancelling out Gary Ringrose's effort for Leinster, and Ian Keatley kicking the extras for Benetton to send them 7-5 in front. But an attacking platform for Leinster here just inside the Benetton 22 as Devon Toner takes the line out from Ronan Kelleher, and they do have another penalty advantage. Benetton, I think, either taking out Toner in the air, but as this maul moves forward, edging their way towards the line, or around 10 metres from the line now, Luke McGrath though looks like he's going to pick it out the back with a penalty advantage. Johnny Sexton chip over the top, and Rory O'Loughlin goes for it, and it's billed, but it is come back for Leinster. And who has it there, being tried to be bundled over to the line? Leinster working their way over the line. It looks like they are going to be held up, but I'd say we are coming back for a penalty advantage. They did have the advantage. Johnny Sexton went for it. The penalty is given around 15 metres from the Benetton goal.
I have some sympathy for Dean Budd, the try scorer, because it was a quality line-out defensive maul. He swung in around and kind of a roundabout system, like a clock, anti-clockwise, and he just gave a big number 5 jersey who's standing straight in front of the referee. But it was a really good defensive system. And Leinster aren't bullying Benetton up front, certainly not.
And they go back into touch with it. They are just 5 metres from the Benetton line now as they look to set up another attack. There were a couple of decent mauls from Leinster so far in this corner of the pitch, right on the right-hand side of the pitch, as Kelleher finds Devon Toner again towards the back of the line-out, and Leinster tried to set it up. And is Kelleher going to try and get himself to the back of that line again as Leinster work their way towards the line? They are getting closer and closer, but Benetton are holding them back, and it looks like illegally so. Is that Leinster told to use it once by the referee? But it is taken to ground, and Luke McGrath has it, and he has Cian Healy outside waiting to take on a hard carry, but it is slowing up and slowing up as Cian Healy gets on the ball, but he's stopped well, stopped in his tracks. And Devon Toner with a head of steam, but that's another really good Benetton tackle, stopping him 5 metres from the goal. Really flat pass from Luke McGrath as if Rory O'Loughlin tries to get over the line. It is touchdown. I think the try is given as Gary Ringrose actually gets his second try of the game. Absolutely, really powerful carry. It looks like we are going upstairs to check this. The referee, Pierre Brousset, looked to have been unsighted, I think, and we are going to the TMO, but it looks, Andy...
I think it's a clear try. Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt.
I think it just looked like he was unsighted by one of the Benetton players who came in around the corner and I think picked up the ball after Gary Ringrose had tried to get over the line. It's a definite try. He gets his arm down, gets the ball down, perfect pressure, straight under the post, and Leinster are going to go back into the lead here. We're waiting for the referee to confirm it, but he runs in under the post, and the try is given. Gary Ringrose, his second of the game, inside the opening 15 minutes in his first Leinster appearance of the season, and they now go 10 points to 7 in front, but Johnny Sexton has an absolutely dead simple conversion to make it 12 points to 7.
Again, I have a feeling for Benetton. Their line-out small defence is absolutely fantastic, and they're putting so much resources into defending that there's a little bit more space out wide for the likes of the Leinster midfield to attack.
I think the Leinster midfield then, I suppose, in boxing lingo, you might say they're just throwing a jab. No need for a real knockout punch or a super power play. They're just hitting the line so flat. Every single time Benetton have to make a soak-up tackle, and they just, Ringrose took it so flat to the line, he only needed to reach over.
Benetton once again with the kickoff going left and targeting Quaylen Doris, who brings it just outside the 22 as the penalty is given once again. That's the second time in a row now off the kickoff after Leinster scored their try. That Quaylen Doris has taken the ball out. This time, it's not a penalty. I think the game has actually been stopped. Is there a bad injury for Doris? I'm not sure, was that a penalty the referee has given, or has he just stopped play? But Quaylen Doris is down, and it doesn't look particularly good. There are some medics on straight away to treat to him.
Well, you can see what Leinster are doing. You hinted at it earlier on, Dunner, about the difference between this and Ireland, the World Cup. They have an exit strategy that requires use of space in the ball and varying the point of attack. The problem for Leinster so far, it's only in the opening stages, is they're not dominating the breakdown area, and they're not getting front. So although Doris carried in very, very powerfully, they're not clearing it out with enough. Violence is not the right word, but to give a platform for Luke McGrath just to whip it away so they can go on to the part of their exit strategy. So it's falling apart a little bit at that stage.
Yeah, and it's worth noting Doris has rolled over onto his back. It's good to see movement there, and hopefully a little less serious than it first looked. But in terms of the exit out of your own deep territory, I do still question the validity of teams passing to a runner who will potentially make 2 to 4 yards and then kicking it, as opposed to just kicking it in the first place. Is there a necessity to put such mileage on your players physically?
But if Benetton have three people in the backfield,
they're still going to have three people in the backfield if one of your props runs into the...
It's one of the few occasions in the game where you have an opportunity to ask questions along the 70 metres of the width of the pitch. So I would think, yes, definitely, but not if you give it to a fatty who trucks it up into a bunch of other fatties.
Sure.
I don't think there's any value to that, because that's just painting by numbers.
But
what Leinster are certainly looking like doing, and from Keane Healy's first carry, it was a drastically different carry than he had been in a green jersey. So he was asking questions of defence and probing at that. I just think if they can secure the ball better, they give that opportunity more oxygen, if you like.
Yeah, Max Deegan.
Have an out half like you sitting in the pocket. You can swing it away, wiper it down anyway, you know. That option is always zero ball. Is that what you call it?
That's it. 0 degrees, stand in the pocket, nail it 60 metres.
Thanks for coming.
Quaylen Doris is off the pitch, but luckily for Leinster, he was able to stand up and walk off, helped by the Leinster medics. It just looked like as he carried that ball, he was tackled and just slipped in and I think collided with with Nathan Manu, the Benetton player.
The referee is actually,
checking
the replay.
Yeah,
he wants to rule out any dangerous play, really.
But as we can see here, this is Doris carrying it in. He's tackled okay, and he just seemed to dip and collide with Nathan Manu, the Benetton number 8. And I think he almost just fell into his chest. He has gone off now, Quaylen Doris, replaced by Max Deegan. I would imagine for a HIA, but it would be surprising to see him back at this stage. It looks like the referee is finished checking, and we're going to see if he takes any action here against Benetton's Nathan Manu.
There's no issues with that.
You can't
factor for Quaylen Doris falling, you know?
No, let's hope he uses common sense here.
Benetton captain Alberto Scabri called over to speak to the referee, as is Johnny Sexton. It looks like he's just going to explain the situation. It does seem a complete accidental collision, but the call is it's going to be a Leinster scrum just outside the 22 as we get play underway, and it looks like it was a fair call in the end. Not really much Nathan Manu could do in that situation, but Leinster now 22 metres out from their own goal, midway between the posts and the halfway line. They are going to have the ball. Luke McGrath getting ready to feed it into the scrum with Andrew Porter, Cian Healy and Ronan Kelleher ready to take it.
Now this one here with a 17 metre blindside on the 22, I just love the idea of going down the right hand side and again giving Kearney the opportunity on the right wing to put a doubt in the blindside winger for Benetton. But all too often we don't see that. The back row move, unfortunately, has seemed to drift it into the subconscious of old-style rugby.
It's like fashion trends. They'll come back into
fashion. Yeah, it was a shame, because that's the perfect thing. I know with Deegan after coming on, the last thing he's thinking of is just slipping down. But it is tailor-made for it. If he just... A nice, clean strike down the right-hand side, and it forces, absolutely and utterly forces then Sperandio into a decision. What does he do? And you can always then drill it down the tramp tracks.
It's like your fur collar, Liam, that you're wearing today.
The option is there.
No one's really wearing it at the moment except you, but maybe everyone's going to follow suit.
It says a man who's wearing my gloves.
I'm very thankful for them.
We are still waiting for this scrum to set. It has been a couple of minutes. 16 minutes on the clock, which doesn't appear to have been reset yet since it was turned off. But Leinster 12 points to 7 in front, giving up that that lead early on after Gary Ringrose's opening try, with Dean Budd scoring on 9 minutes. But Leinster did get back in front. Gary Ringrose got over for his second of the game, converted by Sexton, as Luke McGrath feeds the scrum. And they don't go to the blind side. They go out open as Rory O'Loughlin carries it and gets a strong carry 4 or 5 metres now outside the 22, as Sexton gets the ball well now. And in the end, it's a good tackle from the Benetton defence as they knock Leinster back a yard or two. James Ryan now with a carry, and he gets another couple of yards as Max Deegan gets in on top and covers, and Johnny Sexton, they go blind, but that's a knock on from Ronan Kelleher, and it is going to be it's actually going to be a penalty for Leinster. It looked like Ronan Kelleher was tackled early by the Benetton prop Marco Riccioni.
Well, it's the role that Duvenage is playing, the scrum half for Benetton. His defensive position from the scrum, the far side of the pitch, was excellent. He made the tackle in midfield, but he blocked that inside pass, didn't he? So Sexton was expecting no white jersey to be in the way, but the scrum half was the man who got in the way.
And Sexton now just 5 metres in from the touchline, 10 metres out from the 22, is just going to kick it. And he gets it just inside the Benetton half, really. Not too much distance on it. The angle wasn't great, but Leinster with possession just inside the Benetton half. Looking at one, two, three, four, five, six-man line-out, I think. Or is Josh van der Fleer going to come in? He might be standing at scrum half. A six-man line-out with Luke McGrath at the front. But it's Reece Ruddock who takes it in the middle, and Devin Toner now with the ball at the back of the ball as Leinster look to set up an attacking platform. Luke McGrath egging on the Leinster players and is appealing now for it's actually a great steal from Dean Budd, and Benetton have actually taken the ball brilliantly out of that maul, working their way right up through the middle. Luke McGrath wasn't happy, but Benetton have turned it over as Ian Keatley gets it out now, and it's Scabbery who passes it out to Jaden Hayward, the Italian international who worked his way outside, and that's a brilliant offload to Nacho Brex, the Argentinian who's looking to qualify for who has qualified for Italian citizenship, yet to get his first Italian cap though, as Benetton tried to work it back out again. And that's another brilliant offload in midfield. They're certainly looking to play with it as their attack is stopped midway between the 10 metre line and the 22. Ian Keatley now finds Jaden Hayward, and they go out to the wing to Angelo Esposito, who's swallowed up by a combination of James Lowe and Duvenage now to Ian Keatley, and they're working their way from left to right and back from right to left again, but they are stopped. That was a very good tackle from Andrew Porter, but not rolling away is the call against one of the Leinster players, and it is another penalty to Benetton, 40 metres out from goal and straight in front of the post. And it'll be interesting to see. I think it was Ronan Kelleher or Reece Ruddock who were pinged for not rolling away there by the referee. But is this a chance that you think Ian Keatley might try to have a little kick at goal and cut the arrears back to two?
I would have thought so. It's quite central, so a kick for the corner would be quite difficult in terms of accuracy. But it does look like he's going for the corner here, actually. But that was a timely reminder of what Benetton can do, passing out of the tackle on three separate occasions, using the full width of the field. They do look very dangerous when they allow themselves to play that way again. It was a bit like that Munster game last May, some brilliant attacking play.
It's actually some pretty fearless stuff so far from them, isn't it, as well? The way they're going right from coast to coast on each side of the pitch, putting these opportunities into touches. Ian Keatley actually gets it a pretty decent
distance this time round.
Yeah. He kicked it from 40 metres out. He's probably only 10 out from the goal now as Hamai Faiva looks to get it into the line-out. And you would expect that Benetton, just like last time, a lot of pick and goes before they eventually work their way over, and they bring it up to the front where it's taken by second row Erne Herbst as they look to maul their way over, but it is broken down, and Leinster now look to stop it. But Benetton have taken the ball as Duvenage gets it out now, and that's Esposito with the carry, but it is stopped well by Leinster. But it looks like we are coming back for another Benetton penalty, as there's a few handbags kicking off here. James Ryan is involved, as is Erne Herbst, the Benetton second row. But it's broken up relatively quickly, and we're going to come back for what I think is a Benetton penalty.
Well, it was an early sacking, or a late sacking, should I say, from Leinster. There was a bobbling ball from Benetton. It wasn't the cleanest of sourcing of all for them, but Leinster came in and sacked a ball, which is illegal.
Andrew Porter was the man penalised on that occasion, as Ian Keatley just tapped it straight back into touch, and Benetton are going to have another line-out 5 metres out from goal as we look at the replay here. And there's Andrew Porter on the near side, and I don't know, that actually looks like it kind of came down of its own volition, I thought.
Well, he was the impetus for it.
And that's stolen by Leinster. Brilliant work from Devon Toner, and Luke McGrath eventually brings it up, and Leinster have control of the ball here 5 metres out from their own goal as they look to pick up a couple of short little carries before attempting to clear their lines. Johnny Sexton barking instructions to James Lowe, getting him to get back out onto the far side of the pitch as this pot of forwards now is taken up, and Devon Toner getting in on top of it and sealing it for Luke McGrath. Josh van der Fleer comes around to the blind side, but it looks like Luke McGrath is going to have a kick here to try clear the lines for Leinster. Benetton looking to counter ruck as Luke McGrath kicks it, and we do get the ball out into touch in between the 10 metre and the 22. A good clearance from Leinster and a great steal from Devon Toner.
That was one for Toner's genetics. He was barely lifted. That was just pure 6'10" of height. He probably got 2 inches off the floor, but his reach got in the air. He famously wasn't served in Copperface Jacks. Remember that, Liam? The barman thought he was standing on a box on the other side of the bar, but refused to serve him. This is years ago, actually happened. So I know it's great to see Dev coming back into a bit of form now.
Faiva getting ready to throw. Oh, and a lovely little move from Benetton. No lift at the front of the lineout, and they only get a couple of yards out of it before Leinster react. And another strong carry, another good tackle from Devon Toner there as well, as the ball is taken out, skipping Bram Steyn, as Benetton send the ball towards the centre of the pitch, and it's turned over by Leinster, and Josh van der Fleer has it now, and Cian Healy with the carry as Leinster bring it up to 40 metres out from their own goal, and another strong carry edging them up towards the halfway line. Luke McGrath, they've got numbers now on the blind side of the pitch here, and Andrew Porter throws a wild pass, eventually taken by Gary Ringrose, and it looks, is it Johnny Sexton who was taken out late? There is a Leinster player down. I think it might be Johnny Sexton.
I think he's winded more than anything else. I think it was just a heavy
I think rhythm. He just took a heavy knock after there, he passed the ball.
You see there, Neil, the good and the bad and the ugly of what Leinster have been doing. There's some beautiful offloads. Like, we haven't, like, it's a part of the game that has lain a bit dormant. It's been frustrating during the World Cup watching Ireland play. But the amount of offloads, Josh van der Fleer gets an offload. I think he received a pass on the turnover to begin with. Mm-hmm. He gets an offload. Gets to Cian Healy. He gives an offload. And the couple of, it just seems to be slowing down for Luke McGrath. He's just not getting it away as quickly. It's not his fault. There's a little bit of heavy traffic around the ball. He's just not getting it away as quickly as you'd like. And that 30 metres slowed down and then ruined the kind of outbreak, if you like.
Yeah, it was a penalty for a tackle off the ball on Johnny Sexton. Andrew Porter, he actually threw a fairly poor pass that ended up missing Sexton completely. And it was Nasser Manu, the number 8, who I think was trying to anticipate Johnny Sexton getting the ball. Took him out. Wasn't the dirtiest tackle in the world, but just a tackle off the ball and a chance for Leinster to get into Benetton territory.
I've seen he's done that 3 times now in the game, and as an out half, I know you always know when this is
when a number 8 wants you.
Yeah, well, I think that's obviously preconceived. It's probably Kieran Crowley, and it's a well used tactic for Sexton, because sometimes his body language, he gets irritable, and teams go after him and see can they ruffle his feathers, and it's the 3rd time that's happened, so it'll be interesting to see how Johnny responds. I mean, there's a heavy hit. He's a bit winded. He's got to recover from that. He's got to keep cool. So I'm
but
sure
Manu's
he's
a big unit. Leinster. Yeah. Unit. Like, Leinster. So it might not be a dirty tackle, but boy, he's going to hurt him.
Leinster tried a little trick play a second ago there before it was called back. They had Ronan Keller throwing to Luke McGrath, unlifted at the front of the lineout, but the lineout wasn't set at that stage, but they reset, and in the end, James Ryan has taken it up at number 2. And another very good defensive maul from Benetton as they get in on top of things. And it looked like they'd almost turned it over. Has it come to ground? And that's a turnover for Benetton. And that's some brilliant work by Marco Riccioni, the tight head prop, to get in and work his way across.
I have a question for Liam, because it was always obscure and mysterious to me as a 10. Is defence, maul defence, an art form, a tactical thing, or is it just about brawn?
Because no, it's all of those things. There's a violence about it, but what Benetton are doing is, and they did it in the far side of the pitch, they're allowing the Leinster pod to come down, and then one player is pulling the outside lifter and the other player is pushing the inside lifter. So they're rotating the pod that has just lifted and is destabilizing entirely. And then they're filling in onto it. So they're not necessarily coming through the gate, but they're coming through the gate that they create. And all of a sudden, the Leinster lineup maul, which has been hugely important for the last 10 seasons, is getting no real ground. Like, the scores have come from midfield. So that's great, great lineup defence. But there's an awful lot of technical stuff going in there.
Yeah, a combination of tight head prop Marco Riccioni and the open side Bram Steyn as well.
Pitch, when he came around, he just tried to rotate the pod, the Leinster pod that is.
Duvenage feeds the scrum and a strong carry there at first centre by Alberto Sgabri, the captain, as they try to work their way back along the blind side. Taken now by Giovanni Pettinelli, but it looks like a knock on. Leinster peeling for anyway, but it has been called back. There is a knock on in the carry there.
The assistant referee, in fairness to him, signalled it. It was a little sloppy, wasn't it?
Yeah.
But they're lovely to watch, Benetton.
I think Lancaster, most top coaches are sticklers for detail, but the end product for Leinster not quite there. The start and the middle seems to be looking quite nice.
But we can't take away as well, it's been diluted by World Cup players and,
sure.
In that sense, we, I suppose, should be a little bit...
I suppose so. A little bit of indiscipline in their own territory with a few penalties, and then maybe getting down the phases, they're not quite executing and holding ball. But
and surely a penalty advantage coming here for Leinster. Yes, there is, as Duvenage steps up ahead of the offside line, and a lot of his teammates then outside him carrying as well. And Leinster do have the advantage as Johnny Sexton feeds the ball out to Gary Ringrose, who has stopped well. Ringrose actually sporting a little black headband around his head this afternoon, maybe a little cut lingering from training over the last couple of weeks, as Leinster still have advantage. Brilliant run through the middle, and Ronan Kelleher now, the try scorer here of the last few weeks, 6 tries this season. He stopped just inside the 22, and a chance for Leinster to get some work at Gary Ringrose. Skip pass out now to James Lowe, who holds off a couple of challenges and is stopped around 5-6 metres from the Benetton line out on the left-hand side of the pitch. Luke McGrath working it back outside. Devin Toner now, strong carry, 10 metres out from the Benetton line. Leinster 12, Benetton 7. 27 minutes gone here. 2 tries for Leinster so far, both for Gary Ringrose. Appeals for a high tackle against Benetton there. A good skip pass, and Rory O'Loughlin carries it up the middle, skipping James Lowe as Luke McGrath has it now at the base of the ruck, and finds James Ryan with a short carry, just gets a couple of yards, and another penalty advantage for Leinster. 10 metres out from goal, Johnny Sexton chips over the top, and it looks like it's taken by Benetton, so we are going to come back for the penalty. And some lovely play by Leinster over the last couple of minutes as they work their way closer to that Benetton line, Liam.
You saw the carry from Toner there, didn't you? But Riccioni, the tight head for Benetton, was a marvellous chop tackle. But if he doesn't come off with an assessment of his head after it, he lay on the ground for what was like about 5, 6, 10 seconds, and he's now getting treatment. But he didn't move at all.
Up onto his knees, thankfully, at this stage,
say. He's transitioned from where he made the tackle, which is about 15 metres of a distance, and then he pretty much collapsed again. We unfortunately, the monitor is showing us a further stage of it, but he needs to come off.
I think we are looking at, is there potentially a high tackle? Yeah, that's where the penalty came, a high tackle on Ronan Kelleher. Just that seatbelt effect, arm over the top of the shoulder. It would be a bit surprising if we saw anything more than a penalty here, Andy.
Yeah, I think just a penalty offence. Straightforward enough, I don't think a yellow. But we spoke a few minutes ago about how do teams like Benetton, who can do the pretty stuff well, how can they transition into being a more successful side? They've successfully defended the maul. They've successfully held up Leinster's scrum. Duvenage, their scrum half, just so lazy when his tight head's doing that much work, just walks offside at a scrum, gives Leinster a penalty.
Ran offside at the scrum. I mean, shot up.
As you get it older, as a 9 or a 10, that's where you learn.
And we are going to get a card here for Benetton. It is...
But if I was to say, if I interrupt you, Dunner, the big thing that they have to do is the penalty count is outrageous.
Yeah.
The penalty count. So if there was one message you'd have to give in, I know it's a classic one, limit the penalties, and it's easier said than done because of fatigue, but they've such a quality platform for themselves. They're making life very hard for Leinster, and then they're giving them freebies.
Lou said prop Nicola Quaglio is yellow carded for that high tackle on Ronan Kelleher. So he's going to spend 10 minutes in the bin, 27 minutes on the clock here. And Leinster yet to decide what they are going to do with this penalty.
And his tight head should also have gone off. I don't know how he survived.
He is still on the pitch here. He is standing up on his feet.
Yeah, I'd have serious question marks over that.
But we do have a replacement coming on because it looks like Leinster are going to scrum this ball down around 15 metres or so out from the Benetton goal, just to the left of the post.
Now, can I just set a scene here, right? So James Lowe is the blindside winger, right? There is now about a 22-metre blindside, right? Now, if you are the defending winger here, you want to get a player across. It'll be interesting with Benetton stack on the far side here and put an extra put your out half or put someone in there.
They've got to.
This is 100% coming to James Lowe. And it's a one-on-one with that space.
If not, why not?
The defender.
One of the most underutilised things in modern-day attack is the 8 to 9 to 11, because it's very tricky skill to get the 8 passing to the 9 while he's under pressure from the opposition 9.
And both moving that way to the left, kind of on the move.
Exactly, but when it's done well, it's almost impossible to defend.
Now, Keatley is in the neutral position, so he's kind of hedging his best, but also as Larmer, so this could be really interesting from Leinster.
I can't quite see now. It looks like Benetton have gone for 8 in the scrum as well. I'm trying to spot the numbers there. They are down to 14 men. Nicola Quaglio has just been yellow carded for a high tackle on Ronan Kelleher. 28 minutes gone here at the RDS. You're listening to Off the Ball this Saturday. Leinster against Benetton Treviso. I'm here alongside Andy Dunn and Liam Toland at the RDS. Leinster 12, Benetton 7 at the moment. 2 tries for Gary Ringrose on 5 and 15 minutes.
So 3 has gone off. So he's eventually gone. I'm amazed from a player welfare point of view how it's taken so long for Riccioni to be taken off.
And two replacement props on the pitch at the moment now. Enchil Macalera is on.
It's outrageous.
Federico Zani is on in place of Qualia, who had been sin-binned, while Tiziano Pasquale has come on for Riccioni, who is going off for a HIA inspection as he's led off the pitch. So a blow for Benetton, two front row players off at the moment and two replacements on as Leinster have the feed into the scrum here, 12 metres out from the Benetton goal. And we'll see here, will they move to the blind side? Max Deegan with the ball at his feet as Jordan Larmer moved to the blind side, but Deegan broke out himself onto the left and is stopped around 10 metres out. Luke McGrath now, strong carry from James Ryan as Leinster work their way out on the right-hand side of the pitch, just in between the posts and the far-right touchline as McGrath comes back inside now. That's a lovely little move there. And is it Gary Ringrose again that's working his way towards the line? Leinster are only around 3-4 metres out now, and they're being told to use it. Another short little carry there, another quick little burst, as Cian Healy has the ball at the base of the ruck now, and he tries it. James Ryan getting in over him. Andrew Porter with the next carry. 2 tries last week for Andrew Porter. Good start of the season for him. His first appearance last week against Connacht. And Ronan Kelleher has worked his way over, breaking from the back of the ruck from about 2 yards out. And this try-scoring machine, this absolutely flying it in form hooker, 21 years of age, his European debut, his 7th or 8th appearance for Leinster in all competitions, his 6th of the season, and a 7th try of the season for Ronan Kelleher. A short pick and go after some good work in the build-up from Cian Healy and Andrew Porter, but Leinster's 3rd try of the day. Kelleher just breaking from the back, throwing a dummy. Bramstein buys it, and from about a yard out, he's not going to be stopped.
It's a terrible score for Benetton to give away, like 100% marks to the Leinster hooker, to be fair. But to leak a try around the fringe as cheaply as that is just unforgivable.
It's Messi and Ronaldo stats, mind you. Goal a game.
More than a goal a game. I think he's, for this season now, we're on 7 tries in 6 games. And it should be a straightforward conversion for Johnny Sexton to make it Leinster 19, Benetton 7 at the moment, 17-7. Ronan Kelleher's seventh try of the season, and Leinster's 3rd of the game as Sexton lines up this conversion just to the left of the post inside the 22, and Johnny Sexton taps that ball between the posts, and Leinster extend their lead out to 12 points. It's now 19 points to 7.
I'm not sure if I'm missing something, but it looks like half the stadium are filing out for a cup of tea. As far as I saw, there's only 25 minutes gone on the clock, but
maybe grab someone there, Jonah. Will you let them know we want a couple of cups as well?
Maybe it's indicative of the mood in the stadium. People feel like it's a job done already.
15,080 people here this afternoon for this Pool 1 game.
I think there's 3,500 of them just gone for a cup of tea.
Just gone for a cup of tea. And the Jacks as well, Andy. You got to get to the Jacks as well. Half time is short. As Ronan Kelleher His try makes it 19-7. And a high kickoff. And Max Deegan now takes it on in place of Quaylen Doris. And it looks now like that is going to be a permanent substitution. Quaylen Doris took a heavy blow but was able to walk off the pitch. Initially, we thought it might have been a HIA he was going off for. But he is back. He is not going to be coming onto the pitch. And Luke McGrath's box kick takes the deflection as Benetton have the ball now. And Jaden Hayward looked like he had found a little gap, but he was stopped well in the end by Dave Kearney out on the wing. As a strong carry there now gets Benetton an extra couple of yards. And Duvenage finds Ian Keatley now, who skips ahead and gets the ball outside to Nacho Brex's centre. Working their way back to the left, short little pods, and Keatley has it now again. And oh, that's a good tackle, almost stopping him in his tracks. As Leinster keep Benetton around 40 metres out from goal, and they work down the blind side. Oh, it's a very good break, and Benetton are inside. And is this a chance? They're stopped around 15 metres from the goal line.
See the speed of the ball, it's really brilliant when they keep that pace up.
Almost similar to Japan at the World Cup at times, just keeping the ball alive and keeping the pace in it. And it looks like Leinster have turned it over here. That's brilliant work as Luke McGrath tries to fish it out from the base of the ruck. And Leinster will hope to clear their lines. They have turned it over now. Kelleher now with the carry. As McGrath has it again, Devin Toner is getting over to give him a little bit of support as he gets ready for the box kick to try to clear the Leinster lines. Luke McGrath now around 10 metres out. The box kick goes up. And he gets it up to just in between the 22 and the 10-metre line. But a bit of a let-off for Leinster after letting Benetton in there.
But that said, the pendulum swung and Benetton's two second rows were defending, 30 metres? Leinster had looked up at all. If you'd Larmer dancing through there, he's going to go through clean, isn't he?
Absolutely. I suppose that comes down to risk management. I mean, are they prepared to give it a shot?
But there's no risk there. If you give it your full back against two second rows with loads of space.
Well, yeah, probably fair point. Larmer against those two boys.
There's
no
chance, lad.
And it's taken there now. And lovely little move there as Faiva tries to take the ball back in the inside, but he's stopped by the Leinster defence. Another strong carry from Benetton as Erne Herbst gives his player support. Keatley now always spots the gap and he gets the ball out to Esposito. James Lowe had shot up in the line and Esposito tries to chip ahead, but it looks like there's way too much on that, and Dave Kearney just watches the ball go out and over the dead ball line. It's going to be a 22 metre dropout for Leinster, but a good little chance for Benetton, but just overcooked with that little kick from Esposito.
They have the option to scrum because it went dead off the kick. Rarely do we see that, actually. Remember when that law came in, Dunner, that was happening buckets of times?
Which
when you kick the ball dead, just scrum all the way back. Don't see it at all now.
No. I think it's...
Esposito had a little bit of a heavy foot there, I think.
Yeah, I was going to say, you tend to see, I think, the execution of wingers to chip and chase has improved. Again, you talk about trends. There was fellas like Gerald Davies and JJ Williams in the 70s for Wales who were incredibly good at chipping and regathering the ball.
Did someone tell you about this?
It went out of the game. I used to watch 101 great tries every morning before school. God help me. I was a strange child. But
you look and see the way someone like Jacob Stockdale does it these days. Yeah, I mean, he just has this uncanny ability. It almost seems like he knows what way the bounce is going to go.
I don't think it's uncanny. I think what the technical aspect of it is, they drop the ball down onto the foot as opposed to bring the foot up
into
the ball.
Yeah.
And it allows for that trajectory to go high with kind of very fast revolutions. You're getting quite a predictable bounce back then.
But there's not much pace on the kick well, so it will slow up.
Yeah, it's like a pitching wedge. There's nothing much in it in terms of weight, but it's getting that nice height and bouncing back for you. So it's good to see it come back into the game, yeah.
35 minutes on the clock. There is a break in play at the moment, as I think it's Benetton try scorer this afternoon, Dean Budd, is down, getting a little bit of attention at the moment. It looks possibly to be on his right arm or shoulder where he's getting a bit of attention, waiting for a scrum just outside the Leinster 22, where Luke McGrath will have the put in for them. As Leinster lead by 19 points to 7 here this afternoon at the RDS, just under 5 minutes to go until halftime.
I think Dean Budd is your type of player, Liam. He's a good old-fashioned pain in the ass enforcer type front five man. He's getting his arms and legs in the way of everything.
Based on what we've seen in those malls as well, there have a few of them in the Benetton pack.
Oh, they are. Manu at 8 is certainly good. But you were asking the question around. There's a lot of technical quality in this Benetton side. It's just, it's the error count, the little handling skills, the little mistakes, the penalties have come, you know, and then Leinster haven't had to play particularly well to get one try from a bonus point.
Mm. It's really just been about taking their chances. I mean, three penalties kicked into the corner each time. And
yeah, but as Donner was saying earlier on, like the quality of the passing is the key difference. Maybe almost no errors from Leinster, but that passing is separating the sides, and the scoreboard tells you it.
The clock is back up and running, and Leinster given a free kick there as Benetton penalised for an early shove as Max Deegan takes it quickly and has Josh van der Fleer in support and gains around 5 or 6 yards before he's tackled by the Benetton defence. Andrew Porter this time now takes a good flat line from Luke McGrath, but he's stopped in his tracks, and it looks as surely an offside there as Ronan Kelleher gets the ball and out to Max Deegan, who has James Lowe outside, or who has Cian Healy outside him. I was expecting James Lowe to be there, but it was none other than Cian Healy waiting outside. Lowe is working his way back out onto this wing now. I think they were anticipating a backs move, bringing Lowe in field, but Leinster now working their way up towards the halfway line as Sexton finds Rory O'Loughlin in from the start this afternoon in place of Joe Tamane, who pulled up with a hamstring injury before the game. Leinster have the luxury, of course, of Robbie Henshaw now on the bench. He missed last week's game against Connacht with illness and missed the opening training of the week, but he is back to full fitness, and Benetton have turned the ball over. It's a penalty for them just inside the Leinster half as their hooker, I think it was Hame Faiva, got in over the ball, and Gary Ringrose it was penalised for holding on in the end.
He does that a bit, Ringrose, when he gets the ball in kind of no man's land and tries to dart up through the fringes or even up through the heart of the breakdown, and oftentimes gets great reward. The difficulty there was he was completely on his own, so when he was felled, the white jersey, you'd be forgiven to think that Leinster playing Ulster because of the similarity of the white jerseys, but he was completely isolated and gives Benetton a real shot. Now, a couple of times they've gone into the corner, and I think when you're away from home, you need to start taking points where you can get them, and 3 points, and with a kicker of Keighley's caliber.
It's exactly what they're trying to do now. Ian Keighley has opted for the kicking tee, probably around 48 metres out, straight in front of the post.
It's right on the end of his range. He's a very, very accurate kicker, but I'd say 40 plus metres is right there at the end of his range. He's not a huge kicker in terms of distance.
And if they can cut this back to a 9-point game before half time, they'll probably be fairly pleased with the way things have gone, despite conceding 3 tries, as Keighley steps up now and gets a good strike. And is it going to reach the post though? It's just dropped under the crossbar. So Andy, you were spot on, just right on the edge of that range.
He had 6 inches underneath the crossbar.
He had the accuracy definitely right between the sticks, but it just fell under the black spot of the crossbar, and Leinster can breathe a sigh of relief. They've been let off. It's still 19-7 as Johnny Sexton sends the 22-metre drop out to the right, chased up by Dave Carney, but it's taken well by Lucas Berendio of Benetton out on the left-hand wing. 5-0. Gets it outside to Keighley, and Benetton moving the ball well. Jaden Hayward, lovely grubber through, and it's working its way down towards the corner as Johnny Sexton gets the ball, and he's got Jordan Larmour outside of him. Oh, and that's a lovely step from Johnny Sexton. Finds Jordan Larmour with the offload. Larmour now putting on the gas, works his way up towards the 10-metre line, and grubbers ahead, and he tries to get through, but Ian Keighley tried to stop him there. Was he stopped off the ball? The referee says he wasn't, but Leinster have got the ball up towards the inside the Benetton 22, but the Italians have won the ball back. A lovely bit of play from Johnny Sexton and then Jordan Larmour, but Larmour's kick just drifting in field as he had to take the long route around Ian Keighley, who was probably taking the good lazy line to stop Jordan Larmour from getting through and overtaking him.
Ungentlemanly conduct from Keighley. But he did a great job to
clever conduct at the same time, though.
He did a great job to check Larmour. It just shows you the power of Larmour. Just put him in front of second rows, and he's going to gain ground all the time.
So Benetton have the ball now inside their own 22. Having been in a really good attacking position just a couple of moments ago, they find themselves having to clear their lines as Ian Keighley is barking his forwards to get into position and give him some cover as they look to clear the lines. It is Devalt Duvenage now with the ball at the base, and gets it back, and that's another carry as they try edge their way up towards the 22 and get a little better angle, take a little bit of time off the clock. Just under 20 seconds to go until we're ready for the halftime whistle, as Duvenage now sends it out to his forward pack, and it's really just slowing down to a crawling pace. A couple of short phases as they go back towards the touchline now. A replacement prop, Federico Zani, taking on the ball. slowing it down. It looks like Bennett Hunter just ready to kick this out, as Ian Keatley does, and send it out into touch right on 40 minutes. And that is the halftime whistle. Leinster 19 points, Benetton 7. Three tries for Leinster, so very close to a bonus point in the second half, and you'd probably expect them to be getting it, guys, but not going all their own way.
And Bennett are back to 15 as well. The reshuffle came back on just before half-time. I like watching. I've enjoyed watching Benetton for a couple of seasons. I really have. Leinster, we were talking about it, Donna, weren't we? It's just the quality, the accuracy they're passing, and where to find the weaknesses. And you get a sense that Larmer, the hungrier he becomes hunting for the ball, or the more reactive his teammates are to get him the ball, let him find the mismatch and just put the ball into him. And you'll see that that's going to reap rewards in the second half, isn't it? But Leinster haven't actually played their best rugby. It's very early season stuff yet.
Yeah, it's characterised by patchiness, really. Certainly from Leinster's exacting standards, where they've been over the course of the last few seasons, a very, very dominant side. Probably because of their consistency when they execute, they've just been patchy, let themselves down in areas you mightn't see happen too often. However, they look like the side who are more experienced vastly. They look like the side who just understand that two or three clutch moments are just going to take them away from Treviso. Treviso look like a side you really want to like. You know, they're trying everything. They're great to watch, and much in the same style as Japan or New Zealand, flinging the ball around. But they too are lacking discipline at key times. So, I mean,
in one sense, you've got to frame it without being negative around Leinster. Obviously, they're at the beginning of their season. So too are Benetton. But that said, Benetton deserve credit for asking questions of Leinster.
Absolutely.
It's where they're actually creating that little poor decision or poor execution, etc., etc. Even the penalties that they haven't converted into scores, you kind of say, oh, that you were mentioned there in commentary, Neil, how if Keatley puts this over, they put 9 points in it. But they had the opportunity to be closer if they had taken 3 points every time they had been offered. So tactically, they're still trying to score tries to win the game, which I think when you're this far from home against the side of the quality of Leinster, it's about getting the scoreboard working on your behalf is more important. And that's the piece where you kind of go, do they understand that piece? And I don't know, do they?
It doesn't look like it at the moment. They look like a game who are a team who just lack that game nous and game management. And I thought beforehand, perhaps with the addition of Keatley, you would see a bit more of that caginess in their general play, but it doesn't appear to be the case. They're not playing cagey at all. They're still playing.
Like you look at the team sheets, and you kind of go, who's actually shining from this? I thought Josh van der Fleer is having a really good game. You'd argue that the midfield of Lachlan and Ringrose are, but the rest are functioning well. Like Porter stepping up, Healy stepping up, actually the Leinster front row are stepping up, but there isn't, like, we have to understand this is like week two for them, for a lot of these guys, really. So
how is Johnny Sexton playing?
I think he's he did a little piece of magic just before.
Yeah, we might talk about that, because we didn't really get a chance to describe that as we were working our way leading up to Jordan Larmer's break.
I think it was Esposito had kicked it deep into Leinster territory. Now, Johnny, first of all, he showed quite a level of fitness and speed to get back and pick it up, but what's instructive to me is I think in this environment, him and many of the other Leinster players feel they have license to do more than they do with Ireland, or certainly when they were with Joe in Ireland. He kind of feigned to kick. He had a beautiful sidestep inside the rushing Benetton defence, and as he got tackled, he offloaded and set up Larmer for, you know, 30, 40-yard break. I always remember Sexton's first Irish cap was in the RDS here against Fiji, and his first touch in an Irish jersey in his own 22 was feigning a kick, sidestepping inside the flanker and making a 30-yard break, which is not something that we've come to know as characteristic in his game, but it's great to see that little piece of magic.
But you know what's hugely important in doing that is having the confidence in your teammates. So, like, you know, people often say eyes up rugby. Eyes up rugby is useless if you happen to be the only one on your team who's got eyes up. You need the other 14 guys to have the same vision and the same understanding of what you're doing. Like, people say it all the time, you know, Serge Blanco, eyes up rugby. But that's all really fine, but it's Philippe Salah wasn't on the same tune, sure, that he's going to be exposed. So from Sexton's point of view here, the fact his teammates react the way they react gives him the open door to try this in the first instance. And there is the subtle differences maybe between what we've been seeing from an Irish point of view,
sure,
and from a Leinster point of view.
I think one area of Johnny's game, and I think there's always ways you can evolve and learn, but years and years ago when I was a young backup in Leinster, Alan Gaffney, who was a brilliant technical coach, went on to be the head coach of Munster. It was an end of season team party. He had a can of beer sitting on his belly, and he was criticising me correctly, and he was saying you don't vary your alignment or depth. And to be totally honest, at 19, 20 years old, I didn't actually understand what he meant. But I see it when you look at a lot of out-halves now. Johnny is taking the ball at the same width and the same depth from nine in almost every single occasion. And what that can do is it prepares the defence. They're used to his alignment. Now, it's very flat. It's very challenging. But if you look at the... We've heard him talk in Lancaster, talk about Tom Brady over in the Patriots. You've got to vary where you stand. You know, sometimes if he's going to run it flat, he runs it flat. Sometimes perhaps he needs to be a bit deeper to free up space for the likes of Larmour out wide.
But it depends on the speed of the recycle, really, doesn't it?
It is a discipline in his game I think he could use. But.
All right, there we have it. So halftime, we're going to take a quick ad break. Leinster, as we say, 19 points to 7 in front. Two tries in the opening 15 minutes for Gary Ringrose before Ronan Kelleher scored his 7th of the season to make it a 10-point game. Dean Budd, in between all those, had got a Benetton level before Ian Keatley's conversion and hit them temporarily in front at 7-5. But two tries since for Gary Ringrose and Ronan Kelleher of Leinster. Comfortable here. One off the bonus point in Pool 1. At halftime, as we go to the ads, it's Leinster leading Benetton by 19 points to 7.
Tech Talk. With Jess Kelly.
Think the 5 minutes of YouTube your kids watch on the weekend is harmless?
As a parent, you should be freaked out. The video might look very innocuous, but behind the scenes, there is this sort of machine that is tracking your child absolutely everywhere.
On this week's Tech Talk, I meet the Irish man working with tech companies to help protect your kids online and ensure they don't have what he calls digital stalkers by the time they're 13.
Tech Talk. With Jess Kelly.
Thanks to mintplus.ie.
Listen and subscribe to the podcast now or tune in this evening at the slightly later time of 5:15.
On News Talk. Exciting afternoons with Harvey Norman. Bring the cinema home with an ultra high definition smart TV and surround sound from Harvey Norman. The cinema experience with no queues and no trailers.
Go, Harvey, go!
At Lexus, we have always anticipated the future. Relentlessly pushing the boundaries of beautiful design and innovative technology, so you're ready for what's ahead. Introducing the new Lexus ES. Our executive saloon combines powerful, self-charging hybrid technology with an exceptional driving experience and the luxury that you expect from a Lexus. Test drive the new ES at your Lexus retailer and choose from a range of flexible payment options. Lexus. Experience amazing.
We all grow older, but what if we could slow the process? In this week's Sunday Independent, our experts reveal the secrets to aging well, both inside and out. What to eat, which beauty treatments really work, the wardrobe essentials for any decade, and the latest science on super aging. Plus, psychologist Maureen Gaffney on the midlife crisis and beyond. While fashion designer Peter O'Brien and personal trainer Carl Henry share their tips on how to make your age just another number. The Sunday Independent. The complete read.
Your to-do list. It's always pretty chock-a-block. There's the things from yesterday you never got to yesterday, and the things for today you'll probably put off till tomorrow. But don't put off saving up to €597. Go direct to Energia and switch to Ireland's cheapest dual fuel bundle. For the biggest savings, the thing to do is to always go direct. Visit energia.ie. Energia, the power behind your savings. EAB €1,510 based on average annual usage. 12-month contract, discounted unit rate, standing charge, PSO levy and carbon tax, T's and C's and early termination fee apply. Valid from October 2019 and subject to change. Verification and T's and C's at energia.ie/EAB.
Life these days is all about compromise. A little give and take. You've got to give a little to take a little. You can have this with that, but you can't have that with this. Well, now you can. The all-new Opel Grandland X Hybrid 4 takes the intelligence of a hybrid and gives you the power of an SUV. With Opel's innovative plug-in technology, efficiency now goes even further. And with four driving modes, electric, hybrid, all-wheel drive and sport, you can tailor your Grandland X's characteristics to suit whatever journey you're taking. Meaning, you compromise nothing and you get everything. The all-new Opel Grandland X Hybrid 4. Discover more at your Opel dealership.
Switch to Air Broadband this Christmas and get Amazon Prime Video on us for a whole year. Enjoy thousands of movies, TV series, Amazon Originals and the Air Sport Pack on us. With unlimited broadband for just $49.99 a month for life. Call 1-800-500-300, go in store or visit air.ie. Air, let's make possible. New customers only, 12-month contract, subject to availability. Bundle activation fee may apply. For full details and terms, see air.ie/Prime Video.
The Killers, in Floating the Mirage Tour. Live, Malahide Castle, June 16th, subject to license. Plus special guest, Sam Fender. Tickets from $69.90 on sale this Friday at 9 a.m. Additional charges may apply. The Killers live at Malahide Castle. Tickets on sale this Friday.
Meet Laura.
Hi.
She's a new Leia Healthcare concierge, here to answer your questions.
Where do penguins live?
No, not that type of question.
What's for dinner?
Or that. See, Laura's part of a friendly clinical team, the first in Ireland for all your healthcare questions. Like,
what does my diagnosis mean?
Can you find a consultant near me?
So if you've a healthcare question, your Leia Healthcare concierge has the answer. Call us or visit leiahealthcare.ie, because it's good to live. Insurance provided by Ellipse Insurance Limited, trading as Leia Healthcare. Leia Healthcare Limited, trading as Leia Healthcare and Leia Life, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland. Available from renewal or purchase from 1st October 2019 on selected schemes for members over the age of 18.
What can you light up this Christmas? Well, you can light up a tree festooned with baubles and tinsel.
Dad, put the reindeer here!
You can light up a house.
Mom, can we put up the lights this weekend, please?
You can even light up a whole town. But the nicest thing to light up is a smile, a face, a room full of everyone. Make Christmas for everyone with a huge range of delicious food and amazing gifts that you'll find at Dunn Stores.
Can I turn on the lights, Dad?
Okay, go on then.
Make Christmas for everyone at Dunn Stores.
You can admire a new Mercedes-Benz from across a busy street, through the gate of someone else's driveway, or through your rearview mirror. But a new Mercedes-Benz can be even closer than you think. Introducing the 2020 range, including eight brand new models at the Mercedes-Benz 2020 sales event from the 14th to the 16th of November nationwide. Mercedes-Benz. Better is closer than you think.
World Day of Remembrance for Road Traffic Victims is this Sunday, so take a moment to remember the 24,389 people who've died on our roads since records began. Over 24,389 families, groups of friends, communities. Let's remember them to prevent further tragedy. Find a service near you at rsa.ie.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
And Ronan Kelleher has worked his way over, breaking from the back of the ruck from about 2 yards out, and this try-scoring machine, this absolutely flying and in-form hooker, 21 years of age, his European debut, just his seventh or eighth appearance for Leinster in all competitions, his sixth of the season, and a seventh try of the season for Ronan Kelleher. A short pick and go after some good work in the build-up from Cian Healy and Andrew Porter, but Leinster's third try of the day. Yeah, you're very welcome back to the RDS. Ronan Kelleher's seventh try of the season has helped Leinster along into a 19.7 lead at the break against Benetton in Pool 1 of the Heineken European Champions Cup, leading 19.7. Three tries on the board. Teams getting ready to come out onto the pitch. I'm joined this afternoon on commentary by Liam Toland and Andy Dunn. Guys, just on Ronan Kelleher before we get the second half started, as Benetton come out onto the pitch, is he someone who has a very good chance of getting into a Six Nations squad for next season on this form, surely?
I'm not so sure just yet, but there's definitely a wide opening for a hooker to solve the Rory Best departure, but I'm not so sure just yet for him. But like, it really is down to the coach. What sort of a clean slate does he want to go with? For me, though, the numbers of the first half, 14 defenders beaten today. Leinster have beaten 14 defenders in 40 minutes. That's a statistic that's almost unheard of in terms of what Ireland have been doing in the last little while. It's really encouraging to see how the ball carrier is moving the defender around a bit. That's, for me, that's my kind of takeaway. And get Larmour on the ball earlier. And they don't have to necessarily work as hard to find those scores.
Yeah, we talked about a couple of periods in the first half where they preserved space for the guys out wide by running really, really sharp, straight lines, but then punch passes across their body. Nice, wide, accurate passes. I think if they maintain that style, the game will, you know, Benetton will tire and the outer, wider channels will open up for the likes of Larmour and he'll wreak havoc.
Looks like there's a change on the Benetton team as well. Marco Fuser appears to be in the second row wearing number 19. Dean Budd, who was receiving a lot of treatment before half-time, the Benetton try scorer, is the man who appears to have gone off as Johnny Sexton sends it deep and to the left of the pitch, and James Lowe makes the tackle, and Benetton recover the ball just inside their own 22 now as they work their way up out of their own territory. Andrew Vort. So that's confirmation that Marco Fuser is on for Erne Herbst is on. So Nassim Manu has also gone off at half time and he's been replaced by Toa Halafihi, the New Zealander number 8, the New Zealander.
I wonder, has he the same brief as his last man had? Get after Johnny Sexton.
Get after Johnny Sexton was the message. But Toa Halafihi, who's in his second season at Benetton, he'd previously played, I think, for the Hurricanes in Super Rugby. And one of two New Zealanders in the match day 23 today. But it looks like Dean Budd is still on, actually. It was in second row. It was Erne Herbst who's gone off the pitch to be replaced by Marco Fuser in the second row, as Leinster recover that line out now on the halfway line. Ronan Kelleher looking to get over into the Benetton half, and he does, and just gains a yard or so as Luke McGrath sends it outside to Max Deegan and Johnny Sexton, and Leinster bringing it deep. Oh, that's a great run, and oh, Gary Ringrose has just stopped short of the 10-metre line and just slipped up, but working their way into the territory, they've got an advantage for hands on the ball. James Lowe now takes it up, but he stopped in his tracks. He was all on his own as Andrew Porter is outside and waits for the carry, and he straps it out to Rory O'Loughlin, and a crossfield kick out here now to Dave Kearney, and it bounces beautifully, and Dave Kearney has Josh Van der Fleer inside. Dave Kearney goes back into traffic and looked to have collided with Van der Fleer and seems to have got away with what looked like a possible accidental offside. But Leinster still have the ball now around 10 metres out from the goal line. Gary Ringrose is stopped and it's sent out to Andrew Porter, who makes a strong carry and gains a couple of yards. Luke McGrath now out to Johnny Sexton, and a big powerful run, great angle from Reese Ruddock, but he's stopped brilliantly by the Benetton defence, and it's sent out again to Sexton, and it is spilled in the end, I think, by Rory O'Loughlin, and Benetton hacking the ball upfield, and it looks like it is just crept out into touch. There is a Benetton man down injured as well. Replacement second row, Marco Fuser.
Well, that's the result of Reese Ruddock. Like, for me, Reese Ruddock was the player of the player in form, certainly the forward in form in the World Cup. And he has had a relatively quiet game tonight, but that was a great line he picked. And he ran into possibly the biggest player in the Benetton side and just flattened him. Ruddock is just a beast, isn't he?
Yeah, physical freak.
The flip side, though, then, is Dave Kearney running what wasn't really particularly good line. Having got the ball in such beautiful space, that kick over the top bounced perfectly, and just decided to come back inside. And
he was hunting to get Josh Van der Fleer on the ball, but the defence was moving as well, so he was trying to open up an opportunity for a support player.
Devin Toner takes the line out, and it is Rory O'Loughlin now who has it and has just knocked back a yard or so as Max Deegan takes up another hard carry. James Ryan getting in over him as Luke McGrath now sends it out to Van der Fleer and back inside to McGrath, who finds Jordan Larmour, or finds Johnny Sexton, I think, and has swallowed up. But Sexton goes again. He stays on. He's got Van der Fleer inside. Van der Fleer, two men still to beat, and cuts inside. He's going for the line. Mm-hmm. And it's outside, and Leinster are going to have their bonus point try. And it is Johnny Sexton who follows up, starting and finishing the move. And Leinster, bonus point victory now, well in sight. 43 minutes on the clock. What a move from Johnny Sexton, starting and finishing it all, making the break. It looked like he'd been stopped, but he found Josh Van der Fleer inside, and in the end it was Sexton appearing back on the shoulder in under the post.
I just changed part of your language. He didn't find Van der Fleer. Van der Fleer, as a brilliant open side, found Johnny Sexton. It's a subtle difference.
Absolutely.
But like Fleer, he's been running brilliant support lines. He's the best open side in Ireland in go forward play. The challenge he has is when he plays against really bigger sides, when when he's not going forward, but his team aren't going forward, that makes it difficult. But the lines he picked, like, don't take away from Sexton, but Josh Van Der Fleer ran a brilliant support line there.
And yeah, you think about the likes of the great sevens. Michael Jones from the All Blacks would always seem to be on the shoulder of a Grant Fox, you know. Sexton was... It looked tackled, actually. He took the ball from the ruck and was held, but just used his strength and his upper body to wriggle out of it. Showed alarming acceleration for a man of his age. He just took off. Lovely support line from Van Der Fleer. And then, again, I mentioned Alan Gaffney earlier. It was an Aussie trade. He would say, always try and get a second touch. He stayed alive, Sexton, for Van Der Fleer's return pass, ran in under the posts.
And has just tapped over the conversion as well to make it 24 points to 7. 44 and a half minutes on the clock. Leinster, the bonus point is wrapped up. All they have to do now is see this out as Ian Keatley gets ready to kick the ball, kicking it nice and high as well as Reese Ruddock is lifted by Ronan Kelleher, and they do recover. It was sloppy initially, but they have the ball back now.
Those kind of moments for the likes of Sexton, player who's constantly under the microscope, he's got to enjoy those. He's got to, and you could see that little emotional little fist pump when he scored. It's the type of thing he's got to just get back into his game, that enjoyment, that joy of playing again. It's nice to see it.
Luke McGrath's box kick is taken by Benetton, and they work the ball. They're just looking to get back into the Leinster half as James Ryan makes a really dominant tackle and sends them back a couple of yards. But Duvenage now box kick into the direction of Luke McGrath, who had hung back there after his own kick. He takes it and is stopped as Reese Ruddock slots in at scrum half. Reese Ruddock turned 29 years old during the week. His birthday there on Wednesday. So happy birthday to Reese Ruddock a couple of days late. Some good play from him earlier on. That brilliant line, as we were mentioning, in that Leinster attack shortly before the try. It's back and forth kicking now. Luke McGrath sending it up, and Duvenage, oh, he's missed it completely, but it's fallen nicely into the hands of Jaden Hayward, and now into Alberto Scabri, the Benetton captain. But they send it back, and they're looking to run it out of defence here, but they've worked, fallen all the way back to probably just about 10 metres outside their own 22 as Keatley now throws a dummy. Oh, that's lovely play from Ian Keatley, and Jaden Hayward following up. And it's a brilliant steal, and Leinster have the advantage, possibly for a knock on, but James Ryan now, and maybe a penalty advantage coming for what looked like a high tackle. And Jaden Hayward shooting up out of the line, and we are going to come back for the penalty. It looked like there were probably only three offences there to choose from. Yeah. But that's taken quickly by Luke McGrath, who's charged up, and Benetton were back 10 metres. That tackler came from quite deep as Reese Ruddock breaks out onto the blind side and is stopped by Lucas Sparandio. Andrew Porter now, as the Leinster try to work their way into the 22, and sends it out to Gary Ringrose, and Sexton now, who drops the ball, and that's going to be a turnover for Benetton as play is stopped. Sexton just taking his eyes off the ball, it looked like, to look ahead and see what was coming to him, and it's actually a penalty turnover now. Sexton was holding on to the ball a little bit too long, and Benetton are going to have a chance to clear their lines.
Well, just talking, another mention of Josh Van Der Fleer. That was absolutely brilliant play. He made a tackle, he got back in his feet, swung, but used the momentum of the Benetton ball carrier, swung back in his feet and stole the ball. Great, great play. He's just having a brilliant last 5-10 minutes.
Oh, that's incredible from James Lowe. The kick looked for all the world like it was going out into touch, and James Lowe, massive leap to catch the ball in midair as it was going over the line and flick it back in. And it, in the end, has won back about probably 10-15 yards for Leinster. And I'm trying to see who has the put into this line-out. I think it is going to be Benetton. But that's some beautiful play from James Lowe.
Yeah, huge skill level.
He got some air on that
leap.
Yeah,
it was basketball style. It looked impossible, actually, how he did it. I don't know how he twisted his body into that.
Because normally players, they just kind of bat it back. But sure, he actually kind of caught it.
He caught it and flicked
and
it back.
And held onto it and flicked it back. But Benetton have taken the ball in now in the line-out, trying to maul it up towards the halfway line as Duvenage now gets it outside, and Ian Keatley now, some W runners, but it's Gabriel's tackle, and a great offload to Ian Keatley, and a flat pass finds Sparandio, who steps inside the challenge of Rory O'Loughlin and bounces off Gary Ringrose and is eventually taken to the ground by Ronan Kelleher, with Josh Van Der Fleer trying to get over it. But Duvenage now with Devin Toner trying to step up, possibly offside, and is tackled there, I think, by Johnny Sexton, is it? As Benetton get it up towards 40 metres out from their own goal. On the ball there, Hamid Faiva, the hooker, and as they get it up again, they're working their way towards halfway. Another strong carry is stopped, and Duvenage now sends it out to the right. Oh, it's a brilliant piece of offloading work, and out on the right is Esposito. He gets 10 metres inside the Leinster half as Duvenage now sets up another attack. A lot of dummies there. Ian Keatley sends it out. It's another strong carry, but stopped by James Ryan. And Josh Van der Fleer gets up, that's batted down. And it looks like it's either going to be a knock-on or is it a deliberate knock-on? Benetton might have a penalty. They do. That's what's given. Deliberate knockdown by, I think it was Cian Healy. And it is going to be a penalty for Benetton. 2-3 metres inside the Leinster half, out towards the left-hand touchline.
This guy, to use a name in Dunphyism, I think this guy Duvenage is a cod. He's done two or three things in the game. He sprinted offside at a scrum at a crucial moment when his pack were front five were doing brilliant hard work. He had a high ball up about 5 minutes ago that he just absolutely absolved himself of any response. He literally walked past it.
And Ian Keatley has just nailed an absolutely beautiful kick, probably only about 2 metres inside the Leinster half, and he has sent it right the whole way down to 5 metres out from the Leinster line.
Superb.
As Johnny Sexton is down, getting a little bit of treatment, but he is back up on his feet and jogging back into position. But a huge opportunity now for Benetton, with Hamai Faiva, their hooker, moving his way out towards the touchline to get the ball. They're slow moving up into the line, into position in the lineout. Leinster ready and waiting for them. Let's see what trick they have. They've actually got their second centre, Nacho Brex, standing in at number one in the lineout. They've got two centres in the lineout there, I can see as well, both centres. And Nacho Brex and their captain, Alberto Scabri. They did try go to number one in the lineout with no lift earlier on. Let's see, will they try something like that again? No, they work their way towards the back, and it is taken. And they're going to set up a maul and try work their way towards the line. But they have advantage now, and they've got an overlap as their hooker, Faiva, gets his way towards the line. And that is a try, and that is a lovely bit of play from Hamai Faiva. Just sending it back in towards the blind side after the maul had been stopped. And they get the ball down, and it's a second try for Benetton. Their hard work has paid off. They might not win this game, but they're very much back in it. And it is Leinster 26 points, Benetton 12 with a conversion to come.
Well, I tell you, give him a huge credit. Obviously, the kick into the corner was perfect. But to throw the ball to the tail as that is, and to trust their hooker, was great, because Leinster were setting up to double bank and get into the air. Just the pace, the delivery of the ball, the players themselves walked into position slowly, but the ball itself was delivered quickly. Early sack. But you can't underestimate the quality that required to hit the tail of the line off from that, because it's going to be defended, and Leinster were trying to, but the pace of the ball was so quick it got in, and then they came around the blind side. A cheap enough score in the end, really.
Mm. Well, I think that's why this Benetton side is so likeable. I mean, there's high skill level there in terms of what we criticised. I criticised them earlier for not pinging the corner on a penalty when it seemed easier to miss it, you know. But he's nailed one from nearly 50 metres there, and then they've hit the back on a very good Leinster defensive line out too. So,
and the conversion midway between the posts and the left-hand touchline is straight between the posts. A second conversion of the day for Ian Keatley, and it is Leinster 26 points, Benetton 14. The try for hooker Hamai Faiva has got Benetton right back into this game. Just 12 points between the sides, 51 minutes on the clock.
They're a dangerous side. They are. I mean, they if they had a better nine, you know, I think they could be doing real damage here.
Andy, not a fan of Dewald Duvenage, the South African scrum half, who's been a few years now in Benetton, 3 games this season for him, but not a fan is Andy Dunn.
No, I think that's fair to say.
Yeah. So Benetton now with possession over on the far left-hand touchline as Duvenage sends a high box kick up into the air. And it is knocked on in the end by Leinster. I think it might have been Jordan Larmour who came for it. Didn't quite get it. And Benetton have the advantage for the knock on, but probably just over now as they get through a couple of phases. Another kick from Duvenage, but it looks to be an easy one for James Lowe to take. But they do have a couple of good defenders up on top of him as they stop him right on the halfway line. As Leinster now send the ball out short, a couple of short phases, and Luke McGrath now finds Johnny Sexton again, who's flat to the line. Devin Toner just outside him, and Josh Van der Fleer and Cian Healy into support as well. As Luke McGrath, Sexton, he has Gary Ringrose running a dummy line, and out to Dave Kearney now on the right wing, who holds up brilliantly, and he's just stopped in the end, 10 metres inside the Benetton half. Andrew Porter carrying with James Ryan in support, and Josh Van der Fleer getting over, and Leinster recycle again as Luke McGrath tries to get it out. He was looking for an advantage for hands-on, but he didn't get it in the end. Rory O'Loughlin now, and flicked on by Reese Ruddock, but to no one in particular. And it's Benetton who have the ball, and they're hacking it upfield. And it looks like James Ryan or James Lowe is going to take this. He's not going to get to the try line. So a difficult opportunity for him, but he stops, dives on it, and a couple of Benetton players hold him up. But Leinster get numbers back in the end to recycle the ball, and they're going to have to clear their lines here. They're just about 2 yards out from their own try line. A fly hack forward after Reese Ruddock had thrown a fairly careless offload. As the skies darken in Dublin, I think the floodlights just darkened a little bit there as well. Leinster picking and going a couple of yards out from their own try line as Luke McGrath picks it at the back, and he's going to box kick out away from danger and sends it up to just outside the 22, but kept in play by Duvenage actually, and Benetton still have the ball as they work back inside the 22. Marco Fusa gets over that ruck, and Duvenage now with a little grubber ball through, but that's to absolutely no one. It's a dreadful grubber, and Leinster easily take the ball. Reese Ruddock with it at the back, and he sent it out.
Like, if you're going to do that grubber kick, you don't want a Leinster sweeper, and Leinster had sweeper, so it was a poor execution, but it's a poor decision to begin with.
And we might have played stop because there is a Benetton player down injured there just around the ruck, but Leinster moved the ball out wide away from that player as Reese Ruddock takes it, or as Josh van der Fleer takes it, and they get towards the 22. Johnny Sexton spots a gap, and Sexton now is outside the 22, but that's a brilliant covering tackle by Bram Steyn, the Italian international at this stage. Bram Steyn, South African born. But Johnny Sexton looked like he was away, and I think is that him? No, it's not him down. I think it might be Rory Loughlin's down. And Jordan Larmour with another brilliant step. He had Sexton in support, but gets his way as they're edging towards the halfway line. But Benetton are over the ball once again, and the crowd do not like that. It I see Luke McGrath. It was Jordan Larmour who in the end had isolated himself, a couple of good sidesteps, but he was taken to the ground, and Leinster concede a penalty. This time, 42 metres out from their own goal, in between the middle, in between the posts and the left-hand touchline. And is this another chance for Ian Keighley to slowly edge Benetton back into this game? Or is this, Andy, just like that last one towards the end of the first half, on the edge of his range?
I think it's right on the edge of the range, and maybe the fact that he nailed the last kick for touch, he might go for it again. But I think Leinster have to be really, really careful right now. 26-14 at this period in the game, they're at risk of actually playing the game Benetton want. Benetton want the game loose, broken up and unpredictable. Half of that is coming from the mistakes from their nine, who's creating chaos by his lack of skill. So actually, the game has become thoroughly unstructured, which is suiting Benetton. He's gone for the corner this time.
Not quite the distance he had the last time, but a pretty decent effort. Probably, yeah, 10 metres out from goal.
I think a dangerous couple of minutes now for Leinster. They really got to kind of tighten up. Reese Ruddock's loose flick pass there is very uncharacteristic for him.
And speaking of tightening up, the cavalry are on. We have James Tracy on. I think we have Michael Bent, Peter Dooley, and also Ross Byrne is on as well. So four changes for Leinster. Their entire front row is coming off. James Tracy, actually, incidentally, this is his 99th game in the blue of Leinster. Next week against Lyon in France will likely bring up the ton for him.
But Sexton got off as well, isn't it?
It is, yeah. Ross Byrne is just on for Sexton, and the line-out is a mess in the end, and Devon Toner recovers. Benetton, they didn't even get their lift right, and Devon Toner didn't even have to jump off the ground to pick the ball off in the end, as Luke McGrath sends it back to Ross Byrne, who sends a crossfield kick to James Lowe. Oh, but that's a lovely take by Benetton. James Lowe slips as well, and it's
if you were complaining about Benetton's shot selection, you'd have to criticise that one, Donner, from Leinster.
Yeah, a very odd choice.
But Benetton have it now as they try to get back up towards the 22. Leinster making a real mess of that crossfield kick. And all straight up through the middle, they try to go as Riccioni tries to get in over the ball, and they send it out, and they work their way out towards the blind side of the pitch. And it appears they're stopped there, and slow phases now as they get inside the 22, and they try to work back inside, but Leinster just continue to make those tackles. Josh van der Fleer tries to get over the ball now, and it's another Benetton penalty again.
No,
for
I
not
want to
rolling
stop
away
you here, because this, they take the 3 points. Take
this
the,
one,
take the three
this
points.
One right on the 22-yard line, in between the goalpost and the right-hand touchline.
All the momentum has gone for Benetton. Just keep taking the 3 points and come back.
And they're
again
going into that corner once again.
Yeah, I agree with you, Liam. Poor choice. They're odds on to score now, of course.
Yeah, but, okay, yeah, but like that doesn't prove the point. The point is that it's still it's still, considering where the momentum has gone. Now, you might say, well, now is a good time to go to the pack. But taking your 3 points is a good reward. And just get back into the half.
Is there a fine line between bravery and foolishness that they've just kind of gone beyond?
See, the thing is that when you're making these decisions as captain or as a leader, like, you've got to take a lot of things into account. And it's much easier to go through that process sitting here than it is when you're actually playing the match.
It's cumulative, though. That's about their seventh or eighth time in the game where there's a kickable penalty. So, you know, if it had taken five of them, they'd probably be in the
and
lead.
And Andy, the real danger here is that Dewald Duvenage has gone off the pitch, replaced the scrum half by Tito Tabaldi. So if Benetton have a chance, it's right here as they try and maul it. But they are stopped and they're told to use it. But they do break away and they start edging towards the line. It is on the ground now, and that's a good carry as they get towards the line. Real danger here. It's spilled back, but it's getting quite loose. And Benetton have the ball now about 2-3 yards out from the try line. They're working their way forward, going down towards the blind side as they work it back into the open again. And short phase after short phase, and it's knocked on over the line. And Leinster are going to have the scrum 5 metres out from their own goal. A wasted opportunity for Benetton and a real let-off for Leinster.
So that outcome doesn't affect the decision in the first instance.
Yeah.
For me, it was take the 3 points. It's a great reward. Like, psychologically, emotionally, you're away from home and you need to give your team, particularly your front five, you need to give your front five the reward when they've earned it, and they've got no reward now.
Yeah, and a frustrated look there on the face of the Benetton players that they
Sports psychology is interesting in the sense that now the negatives have arrived into Benetton's head when the 3 points would give them positive, and they just get back and rebuild it. And that's where Keighley would be able to understand getting field position again. Rebuild.
First scrum for the fresh faces in the front row for Leinster. James Tracy, Peter Dooley and Michael Bent all on the pitch. James Tracy's played in every game so far this season as well, as has Michael Bent, and scored a couple of tries along the way as well. Taking advantage of the game time after so many players are away, and it's a penalty for Benetton. Hard to tell what that one was for. The scrum didn't even collapse. It looks like Peter Dooley is walking away looking very confused as to what's happened, but it is a penalty to Benetton 5 metres out, and surely with the angle this is at over towards the touchline, they are just going to tap this into touch as Ian Keighley sends it out, and Benetton are going to have another huge opportunity 5 metres out from the Leinster line.
Hard to get any insight into what happened on that scrum.
Well, unless you hear what the referee is saying, certainly from this distance it's very difficult to ascertain.
It would suggest,
and the last person you ask, by the way, are the Leinster front row because they'll say we didn't do anything wrong.
And it's taken there as Benetton look to try set up a maul. They're 5-6 metres out from goal. It's not moving anywhere just yet, and they're told for the first time to use it as they start to gain a couple of inches and edge their way towards, but Devin Toner is trying to whip it around the back, and it's broken off, and it's well played by Leinster to stop them short out from the 5 metres out from the line. Benetton doing their best to try and get over, but they're just going backwards a couple of yards at a time now,
and they've no backline to attack with.
Tabaldi outside, his forwards continuing to run with it. Ian Keighley is in over to help out with the attack. As Halafia carries it, and it's a good strong line by Scavery, but he stopped well. And outside now, and they work their way over to the far side of the pitch. They have and they go back on the inside, and it's stopped brilliantly by I think it was James Ryan, a brilliant tackle from an excellent carry. Leinster continuing to repel Benetton here, are working their way through phase after phase after phase, but not getting any closer to that Leinster line. Another big carry and another good tackle stops them 5 metres out. As they work back towards the left, they've got four men between the try line, as a couple more forwards come to help them out. Ian Keighley calling some more forwards. Josh van der Fleer gets in with a bit of a counter ruck, but it doesn't turn over. It looked for a second like the opportunity was there for Leinster to stop that attack. And again, Benetton pick and go and pick and go. And for all their inventiveness in between maybe the 22 yard lines, they're not really doing much with the ball once they get in close. They are keeping it quite safe. Again, they pick and go. We must be up around 12, 15 phases at least at this stage. As all the forwards crowd around these rucks. They skip a man now, but they are stopped again 5 metres out. And it's just a train of Benetton players at each ruck, protecting the ball and picking and going. But at the moment, they're not getting any closer to that Leinster line. Peter Dooley this time makes the tackle. Oh, and it's spilled out. And Josh van der Fleer has it. And Leinster have turned over the ball and they have a scrum advantage. And Devon Toner finds Luke McGrath, and it's out. And it's booted right up the pitch now by Dave Kearney, or by Rory O'Loughlin, as Jaden Hayward has it and brings it back inside the Leinster half for Benetton. But Leinster, a great chance there and cleared their lines as Tito Tabaldi sends a very loose pass. And it's fallen into the hands of Nacho Brex. Nacho Brex, a deep and pointless kick, though, right into the hands of James Lowe, who has all the time in the world inside his own 22 to find touch and clear it and bring it right up into the Benetton half, just inside the 10-metre line. Great defence from Leinster.
Of all people on the field to bring a bit of sense to proceedings, it's James Lowe. Get it into the stand, slow it down. Frantic stuff there for about 2 minutes. Great turnover from Leinster. There were some huge heavy collisions actually in that lead-up period. Very, very aggressive running lines from Benetton. Very, very aggressive defence from Leinster. I think both sides managed to kind of quash each other sufficiently until Leinster turned it over. Yeah, a smart decision by Lowe there to put it into touch, give everyone a breather.
Robbie Henshaw on for his seasonal reappearance for Leinster, his first appearance in the blue this campaign, having missed their opening games due to World Cup commitments, and then sat out last week's game against Connacht with his...
Bit of deli belly, was it? I think he wasn't feeling... I heard he wasn't feeling the best for the last few days.
He wasn't, no. He sat out training as well at the start of the week. It was a late inclusion this morning after Joe Tamane was ruled out with his hamstring problem. Scott Fardy also onto the pitch for Leinster with Rhys Ruddock taking his leave and getting a coat and sitting on the bench as Leinster prepare for this lineout, or as Benetton prepare for their lineout, just about 5-6 metres inside their
it's
own
frustrating
half.
Frustrating watching Benetton there and what they could have done better when they were 10 metres from the Leinster line, and the speed of the recycle was so slow. It just gave every opportunity for the blue jerseys just to swarm up, and it made life really, really difficult for them. That for me was frustrating to watch Benetton there.
The line out thrown in by replacement hooker McAleera, who actually knocked on the ball that led to that turnover for James Lowe to eventually clear and set up this line out. As Tabaldi always, his attempted box kick is blocked down by James Tracy, I think it was.
Like, as
and
I've
it's gone out into touch for another Benetton line out.
There were some massive hits, but they're not difficult. Like, Benetton, when they're at their best, make awkward decisions for the defenders. And in that whole phase, I think you were maybe 20-odd plus phases, there was no decision. It was a hard, it's never easy tackling a guy full flight, but it's easy from a decision point of view.
Spot on, yeah. I mean, further out, in their, when they're attacking from their own territory, they look more inventive. When they get close to the line, they seem to be bereft of ideas other than run hard into the defence, so...
And a brilliant line-out steal there from James Ryan. Gets Leinster the ball back as they work their way up now 40 metres out from goal. And Luke McGrath has it. He's got Scott Fardy for his first carry of the game, who doesn't gain any yards but recycles play. And James Tracy now skips Tracy actually to Ross Byrne. And Ross Byrne finds Robbie Henshaw for his first involvement. And Ross Byrne slots out again and outside there. And Jordan Larmer jinking and jiving and not gaining much ground, but causing a bit of uncertainty in the Benetton defence as Michael Bent carries it up now just over the 40-metre line. Leinster retaining possession, and Dave Kearney just overrunning that chance there, but Devon Toner has it now out from Ross Byrne, and James Ryan gets in over him, and Luke McGrath holds onto it just for that split second longer, and it sets up Dave Kearney to work his way inside into the Benetton 22. And he's just reached out a little bit too short of the try line, trying to recycle it, and it was knocked on in the end, and cleared away with a kick by Benetton, but to James Lowe now, 40 metres out from goal, is just standing and just sizing up his opportunity, and he does it well because he has set up a brilliant opportunity there for Leinster, who have been stopped. And Gary Ringrose now picks and go around 20 metres out from the try line. Leinster have a penalty advantage, I think, possibly for a high tackle or a tackle off the ball maybe. The fans weren't too happy as Robbie Henshaw now sends it back inside to Devon Toner, but he stopped brilliantly. And Leinster recycle. Still, they have advantage. As it just gets a little bit messy, and Josh van der Fleer spills it, but we are going to come back And I think it's an offside penalty in the end, the referee indicates, as he jogs back out towards the left-hand touchline a little bit, about 18 or 19 metres out from goal. Oh, no, he's actually going over to his... He wasn't going over to his touch judge. He's right over towards the touchline. Penalty to Leinster, and surely one they'll kick for the corner.
Two little things there, Dunner. When Dave Kearney cut in, he took a ball off the scrum half, which is brilliant seeing the blindside winger popping up like that. But he really looked to offload, and there was no offload for him. Like Josh van der Fleer was busy doing something else. But I think it was Max Deegan then, the ball came to him. He didn't look for that offload, and it was on. And that's that little, like, the absolute best players will find out. If you look at Australia at their best, or the best players, they'll actually be able to just go, I have one split second to offload this, fix my defender, offload it, and then there's a possible try. Two contrasting things. Kearney looked for it, but there was no one to give it to.
Sure.
Whereas Max didn't, and there was people to give it to.
They kicked that penalty right into the corner and set up a maul here. Well taken, James Tracy finding his man. The maul edging its way closer and closer towards the line. Luke McGrath is told to use it, and he's trying to dig it out, and he does so and gets it to Robbie Henshaw with a strong carry, brings it up inside 5 metres, and Luke McGrath just oversteps it, but Leinster do hold on to the ball, and I think possibly a penalty advantage for a knock on from a Treviso hand as they try carry it up, and they do have numbers here if they want to use them out on the open side. Max Deegan now brings it up as they work towards 5 metres out from the try line. James Ryan this time takes it from Luke McGrath, stopped initially but is able to steal an extra yard or two off the ground. Michael Bent, 2 tries already this season as they get about 2-3 yards from the Benetton line. Big line from Gary Ringrose, who's over for the hat-trick. He took it from deep. Lovely pass from Luke McGrath, and Gary Ringrose came from absolutely nowhere. The Benetton defence didn't see him, and he jumped in between two would-be tacklers and touches down about 10 yards to the right of the post. That is Gary Ringrose's hat-trick, and Leinster are surely home now with 68 minutes on the clock. Conversion to come. They lead Benetton by 31 points to 14.
Ringrose hitting that ball at... He's anticipated the pass as opposed to got to the position early, stood still and taken the pass. He's run onto it from, I suppose, 10, 15 metres wide of the ruck. He's only a yard away from the line, and it's a soft enough defensive effort from Benetton. Benetton were actually offside again. You've mentioned it a few times, Liam. Almost every ruck there was 5-6 rucks. Leinster seemed to just get on with it, but the ref... It's a bit of a malaise, isn't it, in refereeing at the moment. Failure to police the offside line is something that is affecting rugby as a spectacle in general, because teams aren't getting any time on the ball, you know, and it's got to be something that's got to be looked at. Because
and against better opposition, Leinster need that to be policed.
Sure,
it's okay here against Benetton, but two big numbers there, Dunner. 10 offloads to 6 in Benetton's favour, but 26 defenders beaten by Leinster to 10. That's a huge, that's very encouraging.
Ross
Byrne makes,
no mistake with the conversion there and sends the scoreline up to 33 points to 14. A relatively easy conversion, around 10 yards to the right of the post. Just 22 yards out, and Leinster in control of this now. 33 points to 14 in front. Gary Ringrose with a man of the match display. 3 tries for him this afternoon. As Tommaso Allen on for Ian Keatley looks set to get us back underway. As the changes all start to arrive here now at the RDS, we're into the last 10 minutes. Tommaso Allen sending it very deep in the direction of Jameson Gibson Park, just onto the pitch, and he clears it straight out. It doesn't go into touch in the end. 10 metres into the Benetton half, but they work it back. And on the ball now is Sperandio, who's tackled up by a combination of Robbie Henshaw, and I think it might have been James Tracy in there. And again, Josh van der Fleer shoots up alongside Devon Toner and puts a bit of pressure on the Benetton defence, but they do get the ball out towards the right wing. And a strong carry by their second row, Marco Fuser. And they'll carry it up again now. Bram Steyn this time getting them up towards halfway, and Tito Tibaldi in at scrum half. Out to Tommaso Allen, who tries to throw a dummy but doesn't gain too much ground off it. Scott Fardy up on top of him. Devon Toner now making a big tackle around the halfway line. As Benetton do look to be tiring even with the options they're taking compared to the opening half of the game. And we are coming back though for a Benetton penalty.
Scott Fardy did an old safety belt tackle there, and you feel for him because whoever's carrying the ball in just dipped below. Just thinking there, Alan at 10 or Keatley at 10. That's going to be an interesting one. I know Alan will be playing for Italy, so Keatley will probably. But when it comes to a crunch games, that'll be very interesting to see which player they'll go for
it's
at 10.
Interesting choice by Benetton to bring in a guy like Keatley, who's highly unlikely to ever feature in the Irish setup again. He's a non-Italian.
Well, actually, I just to interrupt, Ian Keatley is still on the pitch. Tommaso Allan is on, but
he's come on as centre.
I think I might have missed. I think he's on in place of Ignacio Brex, the second centre.
But again, the question is, to a big game, regardless of now, but when it comes to a big game, it'd be really interesting to see who gets the nod. Because Alan has had some really good seasons for Italy. He's a fine player.
You would have thought, for the sake of Italian rugby and development of Italian rugby, that Alan needs to get the nod for those games. I don't know. Who's the new Italian coach?
O'Shea's not officially gone yet, is he?
Oh, is he not gone yet? I thought he'd gone to get involved in the RFU.
Well, not officially yet.
Okay, not officially.
If Conor O'Shea is to leave Italy... Leave a good legacy behind. I mean, the results haven't necessarily been there, but have they made progress?
I had the good fortune to be on a flight with them there not so long ago. We changed seats and we spent about 2 hours talking about Italian rugby. And the results, for the lazy conclusion, would be the results to suggest. Yeah. But what they've done throughout Italian rugby has been very impressive, especially against the challenges. It's a slow-moving machine in terms of the bureaucracy of it, etc. But what they've done, the underage, the skill sets, the way they're playing, they've unearthed a lot of really skillful young players. They're still not quite good enough to be able to match team for team, but they're getting there, and he deserves it. And Steve Abood and all these guys who've been part of that journey deserve. So I'd urge your casual viewer not to be lazy around the results of the senior team. An awful lot of positive stuff has happened throughout Italian rugby that will hopefully bear fruit in five seasons but they're still short of it at this point.
You look at Lancaster with England and he was vilified, you know, but I think 11 of the starting team in this World Cup final were first capped by Lancaster. Sometimes the next coach in takes all the credit, so it'll probably be a little bit like that with Italy once O'Shea is gone.
Well, we've been chatting about Conor O'Shea. You haven't missed much, I can tell you. 73 minutes gone here at the RDS. You're listening to Off the Ball. Leinster 33, Benetton 14 is how it is at the moment. The bonus point secure for Leinster. A hat-trick for Gary Ringrose. And additional tries for Ronan Kelleher and Johnny Sexton as Luke McGrath's box kick goes only in the direction of this is a brilliant play
from Dave Kearney.
And Dave Kearney is the second good tackle in a row he's made on Alberto on Lucas Sperandio. The first of those working it out into touch a couple of moments ago. Before that one, a loose kick. Sperandio, brilliant step inside and just found that gap in the Leinster defence before Dave Kearney with a brilliant cover tackle. And if he hadn't made that, Sperandio could have been in. But it is going to be a penalty for Leinster or for Benetton for an offside. I think it might have been Scott Fardy is being spoken to, unless at the moment that was just his captain, but not offside actually for another seatbelt tackle. And this time Tommaso Allan has the ball as they decide what they're going to do with it. You would expect they're going to be kicking for the corner. If they want to get anything from this game, they're going to need a couple of tries.
After 74 and a half or nearly 75 minutes, I know what the Leinster fans have decided to do, and they're slipping out the door.
Their job is done this afternoon. All 15,080 of them here this afternoon.
I can never understand that, because you never know what might happen in the next 5 minutes. Like the stand.
Even if you only miss a consolation try, it might be an unbelievable.
I'm just watching.
Also, most of them only live around the corner.
Back in Dublin for the first time in a while, I see two big tall cranes.
Andy's trying to edge out of his seat down the seats. Oh, but Benetton have it here. Oh, but it's called back. They went for another short line-out move. Bram Steyn thought he was over the line, but he has been pulled back as the referee. Our French referee, Pierre Brousset, just wasn't ready to go.
There's going to be a cavalcade of Range Rovers down Anglesey Road now as people try and escape home. 200 metres to home.
I have so many things I could add to that, but I'm deciding not to.
I think it might have been a crooked throw in the end that was called back for Benetton. They thought they were in as Bram Steyn crossed the try line, but it was called back. And we're going to have a scrum here for, I think it's for Leinster. I can't see who has the ball. It is Jameson Gibson-Park with the ball in hand. So a scrum for Leinster. 75 minutes gone here. 33 points to 14 they lead. And it looks like they're going to get off to a winning start, a bonus point winning start in Pool 1. Their outstanding home form in this competition as well, dating all the way back to 4 years ago. Their disastrous campaign when they were beaten by Toulon in December of that year at the Aviva Stadium. Coming up now on, I think this is 16 games in a row, 16 wins in a row in Dublin in this competition. That includes pool stage games and knockout games as well that have been played at the Aviva, as Jameson Gibson Park box kicks and brings it up to just in between the halfway line and the 10-metre line inside the Benetton half, with Benetton to have control of the lineout. Overall thoughts, guys? I mean, 4 minutes to go in this game. Will Leinster, will Leo Cullen be fairly pleased with what he's seen?
I think he does an awful lot of encouraging thing. I don't think they had to play their best. I think they could stay in third gear or whatever gear you like to say. But some of the numbers there on defenders beaten has been very impressive. They didn't quite dominate the front five, and that you've got to give Benetton huge credit for that. I think that Benetton have more to learn from this game than Leinster have in that sense. You know, how can you convert that pressure into points, the championship moments, and et cetera, et cetera. And I think Leinster's defence managed anything that Benetton threw at it pretty well. And there's an awful lot of positives with players coming back and Robbie Henshaw coming back, etc.
And Benetton still going for their result. A lovely chip over the top from Tito Tibaldi. And in the end, Bram Steyn just sending it out to the right-hand side as they work their way inside the 22. And Ian Keatley now finds his way. They have numbers here. Sperandio, he has the try score of Faiva just outside him as well. But he chooses not to use him and go back inside. And it's taken up by Tommaso Allen. And Tibaldi breaks and goes, and he gets a yard or two as Leinster tried to stop them one more time. Faiva now slotting in at scrum half with Tibaldi at the base of the ruck, and Tommaso Allen tries to bring it left and dummy inside, but he's stopped easily. And that's another good tackle by Robbie Henshaw, with Benetton now 15 metres out or so from the Leinster line as they try to finish this game in style with a try and work their way through. Ian Keatley with a nice little break gets them to within 5 metres from the line. And now up to within one or two. Bram Steyn with another good carry. And it's put outside, and it looks like they are over the line. Are Leinster going to hold them up? They might just stop them short. But they are just inches from the try line now. James Tracy getting in and making a good stop. Out towards the corner flag, and they work back inside. And it's stopped again. And oh, I think the play has stopped. Has this been turned over? It's a penalty for Benetton in the end. Leinster penalised. And a quick pick and go, and stopped again. I'm not sure where those Leinster players back on the try line who foiled the attack, but the referee says play on. 2 minutes to just under 2 minutes to go here. This is likely going to be the last attack of the game. Tibaldi now, he has his man outside. Faiva goes over and they skip outside, and skip him and work towards the halfway line. Tommaso Allen now, he's got Jaden Hayward, and Hayward out to Sperandio, and he looks to be in. And that looks to be a nice consolation try for Benetton. What is probably going to be the last action of this game, with 78 minutes and 42 seconds on the clock. Benetton have 19 points up on the board. It's not going to be enough, it looks like, for a bonus point for them. But Ian Keatley, I think he's going to try rush this kick so they can have one last attack. But a lovely bit of play eventually after all those phases. And what they didn't do earlier on, guys, get the ball out wide when they had that overlap and when they had that number. Well, just, Leinster just, had sucked
just
in those
stop
players.
Stop you there. If Keatley wants to get this, the conversion is useless to him. It's a try, will give him a bonus point. So he shouldn't even bother taking the conversion. It's of no
he's
use.
Taking
it's 2 points.
Time.
It's of no use to
and
him.
NFL
he's killing the clock.
Up for the 2 point conversion.
And no. Drops it short in the end. It was a kind of an awkward kind of a strike, but they have 30 seconds left. They will have chance for one more attack, but they are going to need, well, they are going to need 7 points, bring them up to 26. They are going to need a converted try at this stage if they do want to get a bonus point.
Well, a try now will give them a bonus point. A converted try will give them 2 bonus points. Would it?
Actually, a try would give them... Yeah, so a converted they try would give them 2 bonus points. Yeah, I forgot about the third try for them.
Conversion was of no use to them.
No flies on you, Liam.
Exactly, yeah. Deep kick, and it is taken now by Benetton, working the way up towards the 22.
Ooh, nice.
Oh, Dominic Harry, James Lowe in the end was knocked back in the tackle, but Benetton desperate to get this ball up the pitch as Leinster come in on top. And it looks like, have they turned that over? James Ryan thought he had it, but he didn't. Tito Tibaldi now out to Ian Keatley, and Ian Keatley has it now and spreads it outside.
That's
way
okay.
Out right. That looked like a forward pass to Sperandio, the try scorer, but it is play on to Baldi now. To Marco Fuster, second row, brought on at half time. Still on their own 22. Tommaso Allen out to Jaden Hayward and skips it out. And a good cover tackle there by Ross Byrne.
You wouldn't bet against it.
As Esposito has it out and tries to get the offload, and it is quite scrappy and it has gone backwards. Leinster wanted the forward, a knock on there against Benetton, but the referee says it's gone backwards as Benetton work their way now in between their own 22 and the 10 metre line. Still a long way to go for them if they are to get their fourth try of the game, and what they hope would be two bonus points if they could convert that. Out to Sperandio now on the left touchline. Over him is Giovanni Pettinelli, his blindside flanker. And Tommaso Allen hit late there and looks to be in a lot of pain in his, I think his ribs or his hip, hit by James Ryan. He's down now as Benetton tried to even get in over the 10-metre line. They're not even getting particularly close to the halfway line, using up a lot of energy. The clock, obviously, well into the red. Leinster, the victory is sewn up, but a converted try for Benetton would give them two bonus points. A try of any kind would give them one, but it's a knock-on, and that is going to be that. The full-time whistle is blown here. Leinster have got their drive for a fifth Heineken Champions Cup campaign off to a winning start, a bonus point victory. They've taken maximum points here against Benetton with a 33 points to 19 win. There are three tries for Gary Ringrose, a hat-trick of scores, the first of those coming 5 minutes in before he got over again on 15 minutes. And then on 69 minutes, it was his score that put daylight between the teams after Benetton had brought themselves back into it. Ronan Kelleher as well, worth mentioning. A try for him, his seventh of the campaign so far. A brilliant start of the season for him before Johnny Sexton, who played probably the guts of an hour this afternoon and I think played quite well as well. A brilliant try for him, making the break himself, starting and finishing the move, with Josh van der Fleer just hanging off his shoulder like a good open side before Sexton repaid that as well and just hung around van der Fleer as he made his break and got in over the line. Sexton adding three conversions, Ross Byrne adding one as well. Dean Budd, Hame Faiva, Lucas Sperandio getting over for the Benetton tries as they just fall short of a bonus point victory. But all in all, guys, a good afternoon's work for Benetton, going through the motions at times, but with a lot of players coming in for their first displays of the season, a decent 5 points.
Yeah, I think there's an awful lot of good things to take away from the game. I don't think that Leinster were really asked enormously questions. Like, you think, like, the difference between, like, you saw all the offloads from Benetton, but ultimately defenders beaten is what creates tries, really, doesn't it? And Leinster had buckets and buckets more defenders beaten, and they had the bigger moments as well. I think you mentioned clutch moments or clutch whatever, and when that happened, the coin always fell on Leinster's favour, didn't it? And that's just the difference in calibre. One is that one of the champions of our domestic league, and the other are bottom of the table kind of stuff. I think Benetton probably would go home and should be a bit frustrated about their performance in many ways. Like the sin binning and the head assessment didn't help their cause, but neither did the errors and the penalties they gave away at the same time. But they're a team you want to win. You want to perform and score tries.
For any neutral, they're a side that are, they're at times they're so creative, you're going to be on their side. Well, what's disappointing from a Benetton point of view is you look at where they fell down at the tail end of last season in the Munster game, and they fell down in the exact same way today. It's their execution, and it's their ability to manage the game in a canny way, in a smart way. And I was quite critical of Duvenage, their nine, who I think was quite costly for them. For them to evolve into a team that's on the better side of results more often in big European games, they need to sort out those decision makers on their field, because they have got quality. I think.
Do they have enough to get a victory in this pool? Their first in 5 years.
I'm not sure in the key positions. I think Keatley has had a reasonably good game overall. I think they've an excellent front five. They've got tons of ability out wide. Big, strong, fast wingers. So yeah, there is a chance, but.
Guys, that's where we are going to have to leave it this evening. Thanks a million for joining us, Andy and Liam. Coming up tomorrow on Off the Ball, Kieran Cunningham and Declan Lynch will be on the paper review. James Downey is going to keep us updated at Connacht versus Montpellier at the sports grounds. We're also going to have a 10-year retrospective on Thierry Henry's handball. Guys, I don't know where you were watching that one, but Kevin Kilbane and Shea Given have come in, or are coming in tomorrow to give us their thoughts on 10 years.
I wasn't in Paris anyway.
You weren't in Paris anyway. Watch on TV. Gary Breen.
Flat on the South Circular Road in tears.
Gary Breen and David Snaid will also be in as well to look ahead to the Republic of Ireland and Denmark. We'll look back on all the Heineken Champions Cup action as well tomorrow on the show, including Munster against the Ospreys, which kicks off at the Liberty Stadium in just under 20 minutes. But until then, from here at the RDS, it has finished Leinster 33 points, Benetton 19. Leinster getting off to a bonus point start. A hat-trick of tries for Gary Ringrose, one for Ronan Kelleher and one for Johnny Sexton, with Dean Budd, Jaime Faiva and Lucas Berendio on target for Treviso. Ian Keatley kicking a couple of conversions.
Give him a ball and he had a grass. He'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and he had a spice. He'll give you a move with guiltly grace. Ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. He's a nice young man. He's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. He's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. He's a lovely smile. With godly grace. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss to his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss to his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss to his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss to his friends.
Screen Time with John Fardy.
Hang on, it's too early for that. But I do have to tell you that this week on Screen Time, I talked to director Paul Feig about his new rom-com Last Christmas, set to the music of George Michael. He also tells me about making Bridesmaids and why he could never make Freaks and Geeks again. And staying with the seasons, meteorologist Evelyn Cusack chooses her favourite movie.
Screen Time with John Fardy.
Brought to you by Stella Cinemas.
Download and subscribe to the podcast now, or tune in this evening at 6.
On News Talk.
Productive afternoons with Harvey Norman. Computer crashed? Don't worry. We have a wide range of laptops that work as hard as you do. Talk to a Harvey Norman technology specialist today.
Go, Harvey, go!
Is this Nissan?
Yep.
Electrician. I'm here to look at the big electric switch.
It's an offer. It's not an actual switch.
What?
Switch to a 100% electric...